Good afternoon to one and all. So today in this session, we are going to conclude our graphs. It has been a chapter which we have been dealing with the last 3 weeks now. So fourth week is running on. And today I want to conclude this chapter. And under this chapter, we need to finish off two types of functions, one being exponential function. In fact, we can take exponential and logarithmic functions together. And there's a reason why we are going to take it together. Exponential and logarithmic functions. So this would be our first part of the session. Probably before 6 o'clock, I should try to wind it up. And in the second part of this session, the much awaited bridge course chapter, Introduction to Calculus. That is what is going to be done in the second part. Okay. I don't think so I'll be able to do much in Introduction to Calculus. Probably I'll be introducing you to the concept of limits. And let's see, if time permits, we'll be able to touch upon derivatives. Okay, so this is going to be our agenda for today's class. So let's start. We don't have even a single minute to waste. Okay, exponential and logarithmic function. I'm sure exponentials are not a new concept to you. Okay, you have been introduced to exponential functions since class 7th. Exponential laws you have done. But I just want to know how many of you have been introduced to logarithmic functions. Let me just take a quick poll. Just say yes if you have been introduced to logarithmic functions before, and no if you haven't been. Just to get an idea about how comfortable you are with the logarithmic session, because there are some schools with autonomous syllabus who have introduced logarithms in their junior classes, like NPS Rajaji Nagar. Okay, so seven of you say haven't been introduced to logarithms yet. Okay, no problem. Okay, never mind. I'll start from scratch, don't mind. Never mind, yeah. Now, first let's talk about exponential function. Now, exponential functions are basically functions of the nature, right? A constant raised to some power, okay? A constant A raised to some power. So let's say if f of x is an exponential function, it is a constant A raised to a power of another function of x. Okay, now here, we normally have this base A to be a number which is greater than 0 and should not be preferably 1, right? If it is 1, it becomes a constant function because it will become just a straight line f of x equal to 1. Okay, you can write it as y also, never mind. Okay. So an exponential function basically has a constant raised to the power of a variable. The simplest of all exponential function that we can come across is something like a to the power of x. Right? So here g of x is basically your x. This is the simplest exponential function you can actually see. Okay. Now, any questions here? Muskan, I've not started anything new. I've just the first slide. Okay. This is the first slide of the session. The previous slides, I didn't say anything important. Okay. But try not to join late. Okay. Because if you miss out the initial part, you lose the track. Okay. So now, the first question that arises in everybody's mind is why we have put this restriction of A to be positive. Okay. Of course, not equal to 1 is something which I already told you, because if you keep it equal to 1, it will become 1 to the power anything is 1. So that becomes a constant function. So we can't call constant functions to be, you know, you can call it as an exponential function, but it's a limiting case of an exponential function. Now, why do we keep A as greater than 0? Now, see, if you don't keep A as greater than 0, let's say if I keep A as a negative quantity, let's say I have negative 1 to the power of, you know, P by Q. Okay. Now, I've taken X to be some kind of a rational number right now. You'd realize here that you can find answers to these expressions only when your Q is odd. Okay. For example, you may find answers to this. When I say answers, my dear friends, please let me know. I'm talking about real values as the answer. We are dealing here with real valued function. That is something which I would like to highlight in the beginning of this course itself, that all the functions that we are going to talk about, they would be real valued in nature. Okay, and I've been telling this since the first class. Real valued are those functions which will take real inputs and give you real outputs. So we are not going to talk about any such functions which are going to deal with the non-real inputs or going to give out non-real outputs. Okay. So when we talk about exponential function, or for that matter, later on, we'll talk about logarithmic functions also in the similar sense. We are going to only talk about those functions which take in real inputs and give us real outputs. So if your Q here is not an odd number, that means if it is an even number, you would realize that the output of it will come out to be imaginary. So in this case, only we get a real output. Okay, right? But in case like minus 1 raised to the power half, where your base here is we call this as the eventh root. It's an eventh root. We have already seen in the past while we were dealing with irrational functions that when there is an eventh root, the answer for this may come out to be an imaginary quantity, right? And we cannot plot them on the real graph. We cannot plot them on the Cartesian plane, right? And yes, correct, Anusha. So that's primarily the reason why we ensure that our domain and range of these functions remain real. Then only we can plot them. Else there is no point, talking about, plotting them on the Cartesian plane. Okay, so that's why your base of the exponential function, that is your a, has to be greater than 0, and preferably, I'm again repeating this word, preferably not 1. Okay, now when you have a greater than 0 and not equal to 1, it divides a into two zones. Okay, so let me write it over here. If your a is greater than 0 and not equal to 1, it divides your a into two zones. One zone is where your a would be between 0 and 1, and the other zone will be when your a will be greater than 1. Okay, it's obvious, right? Okay, so what I'm going to now show you, how does the graph of exponential function a to the power x look like for these two different scenarios? Okay, so let's talk about the graph of y is equal to a to the power x under these two different scenarios. Okay, so let's first try to plot them by choosing some x and y values, because initially when we don't know the skeleton graph, is good to learn the graph by plotting them. So for the first case, let us say an example, a being half. So what I've done, I've taken a simple example of a base between 0 and 1. Half is an example. You may take anything you want, 1 by 3, 1 by 4, 1 by 5, 1 by 10, whatever you feel like you can take. But just for the purpose of simplicity, I have taken half as an example of a number lying between 0 and 1. Okay, no problem with that. Remember, the skeleton graph is going to be more or less the same even if you take any other quantity between 0 to 1. So basically, we are learning the structure of the graph right now. Okay, however, there are few changes in there, bending and all. We'll take that into account after we have plotted the skeleton graph. Right. Now, the first thing that I would like to ask you is suggest me few points on this graph. So if I take x as 0, what should be my y? If I take x as 0 in this, what should be my y? 1. Okay. So the graph passes through 0, 1. So let me just choose a point on the y-axis, 0, 1. Okay. Let's say I take the value of x as 1. What do I get? Half. Okay. So at 1, I get a half. So basically, the point will be here. At 2, I will get a 1/4. At 2, I will get a 1/4. So the point will be here. Right? At minus 1, I'll get a 2. At minus 1, I'll get a 2. Right? The point will be here. At minus 2, I'll get a 4. So at minus 2, this will, oh my God, it'll go up. Okay. Now, we have sufficient enough points to know What is going to be the graph of this type of function. So let me connect it by a dotted line. Okay, just let me connect this by a dotted line. There you go. So this is how the graph of an exponential function whose base is between 0 to 1, more or less, my dear students, will look like this. Okay, of course, if you take it as 1/3 to the power x, now the structure will be the same, but does the bending of this will slightly vary? I'm going to ask you that next. But before I do that, a couple of things that I would like to pinpoint over here. Number one, this graph will never touch the x-axis. This graph is never going to touch the x-axis. That means your x-axis is going to be an asymptote to this graph. Okay? Remember, any exponential function for that matter, whether it's between 0 and 1 or whether it's greater than 1, that will always be positive. Right? Under no situation, an exponential function will ever touch the x-axis. That means its value is never going to be 0. Okay? Now, I'm talking about this case. If I tweak with this, probably it may come down. Okay? So, don't take my word like, if I change this, it cannot come down. For example, if I do a to the power x minus 2, function, of course, it may come down. It may come down to the negative side, right? But this is not a pure exponential function. So, I'm just talking about exponential functions of this nature. Okay. And you'll also realize that this graph is basically rising on the negative side and falling on the positive side of x. Okay. So this is basically trying to say that if you increase the value of x, that means if you go to very, very high value, y will start touching the x-axis. That means it will tend to zero. Now, today I'm going to spend some time on tending to aspect, that is the aspect of limits in calculus. Okay. And if your x starts going towards minus infinity, y will also start going towards plus infinity. So y will start going up. Is that fine? Any question with respect to the graph of an exponential function where the base is between 0 to 1? Please ask. Any query? No questions. Very good. Okay. Now let us take an example of the base being greater than 1. Let's take 2 to the power x for the sake of convenience. Okay. 2 to the power x. Why I've taken 2 to the power x? Because it is matching with half. Okay. In such case also, if you start plotting the graph, let's say if I put x as 0, y is going to be 1. So again, it is passing through 0, 1, right? Again, it is passing through 0, 1. If I take x as 1, what will happen to y? Y will become a 2, correct? If I take x as 2, y will become a 4, correct? If I take x as minus 1, y will become a half. If I take x as minus 2, y will become 1/4, and so on. Now, if you connect them, you'll realize that this is how the graph will look like. Please do not forget to put arrows at these ends because it is still moving. It is still moving. It hasn't stopped anywhere. Okay. Now, again, a quick analysis here. You'll realize that this graph, again, doesn't touch the x-axis, right? It comes very close to it, very close to it, very close to it, but doesn't touch it. That means the x-axis is, again, an asymptote for this graph. Okay. Secondly, as x becomes very large, y also becomes very large, right? And as x becomes very large in negative sense, y almost dies out at zero. Almost dies out at zero, but does not become zero, right? Okay. And between these two curves, the way you see here, this is the way it is, bend in this part, and this is the way it is bend in this part. Between these two limiting cases, there is one special case when it is exactly flat, when your a becomes 1. Okay, so as you can see, the changing point is a equal to 1 over here. So before 1 and after 1, the graphs are different. So I would like you to see this on the GeoGebra tool. So there is a GeoGebra tool. I'll just show you. When you take a to the power x, how does the graph actually change? Okay, so right now, as you can see, it has already taken a as 1 by default. If I increase the value, okay, do you see that rise? Okay. And if you decrease the value lesser than a, you can see the other end will lift up. There you go. The other end is lifting up. Okay. Of course, when you go negative side, see the graph will disappear. Now, disappearing means it has gone, some of the values have gone to the non-real, domain. So we are not going to, we cannot plot them on the Cartesian plane. So only from exactly at zero, it will be zero. Okay. And that too, you can see it is only in the positive side of x. And if you are increasing the value, see, this is the way it is going to fluctuate. See the way it is dancing. It's as if like there's a fulcrum you know, at 1. Okay, you see that? Yes, any question, anybody? Yes, we can plot it in the Argand plane, but let me tell you, Argand plane deals with a different type of scenario altogether. Of course, we can use Argand plane to plot the imaginary things, but Argand plane is kept for a different purpose altogether. It is basically trying. Argand plane is a basic is a way to make complex number take a real shape. Right? It's an effort to study complex number by imposing a real shape to it. Getting my point? But something which is non-real is like you cannot see it, you cannot feel it. Okay. All right. So with this, let me tell you, my dear students, all the laws that you have studied for transformation, all the rules that you have studied for transformation, shifting right, shifting left, shifting up, shifting down, will be equally applicable to exponential functions as well. Right? Okay. Would you like to all do a quick question and move on? Okay. And then we'll take up logarithm, because I'm going to spend a considerable amount of time on logarithm today. So I would just like you to sketch this simple graph for me. Yeah. The graph is, let me give this graph. Let's say mod y plus 3 is equal to e to the power, let's say mod x minus 1 plus 2. Will that be fine, or do you want me to complicate it a little bit more? Okay, that's fine. Okay, fine. Okay, Ansh has a question. If a is minus 1, then most of the values are real. No. When I say most of the values, what do you mean by most of the values? See, between any two value of x, there will be infinitely so many numbers. Ansh, right? Let's say your x is between 1 to 2 itself. Between 1 to 2, you will have infinitely real numbers coming. Correct? Infinitely fractions coming, which has got, you know, even number basis. What will you do with those answers? Those answers will go on to the non-real domain. So the consortium of mathematicians decided that let's not have that complexity, because we don't want to plot the graph only for few selected values. It will become very, very difficult to deal with them. There will be a lot of complexity in plotting the graph. I understand where you are coming from. You're saying that for most of the values, we may get, not, I should not say most of the values, for few selected values, I will get a real answer. Why don't we plot them? If you do that, it will become very, 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 very critical. Very, very critical. Between, let's say, you know, 0 to 1 itself, there can be so many fractions which has got odd number basis. Right? There may be so many of them which have even number basis. It's humanly impossible to sit and plot them. Got your answer, Ansh? Why we don't mess up with, or why don't we entertain negative values of A? Okay. So here is a question. Let's quickly do it, guys. We have learned so many rules and transformations of graphs. Let's apply them one by one. So which is the skeleton graph that you are going to deal with? By the way, E. How many of you do not know anything about E? E, the Napier's constant or the Euler's constant. Okay, Muskan doesn't know about E. Okay, Oshik also doesn't know. Okay, now let me tell you, E is a special type of an irrational number. It's a special type of irrational number whose value is approximately 2.718 dot dot dot. Now, how does this E come? Just like pi, what is the significance of E for us? Okay, that's something which I'm going to explain you in the next 5 minutes. So after that, only we'll take up this graph. But just remember, it's an exponential function whose base is greater than 1. You can treat it for practical purpose like that. Okay, now what is E? Now consider a term here, 1 plus 1 by x to the power of x. Okay, consider this expression E, not the small e, capital E. Let's say this is the expression capital E, which is 1 plus x to the power x. Okay. Now, people who have calculators with them or phones with them, I would like you to give out the following answers to me. Tell me, when x is 1, what is the value of E, my dear? That you don't need a calculator for that. When x is 1, what? Yeah, Kshitij, correct. 2. Okay. Now tell me, when x is 10, what is e value? Basically, I'm asking you 1.1 raised to the power of 10. 1.1 raised to the power of 10. You may use your phone, calculator, whatever you have. I'm sure you must not be having a calculator because you have never used it before. But if you have a phone, you can use it. How much? Approximately. Give me four significant figures. Give me the answer to four significant figures. Okay. So Parvati has given me the answer to four decimal places. Okay. Never mind. I'm fine with that, Parvati. Now do this. Put it to, let's say, 1000. Sorry, I'm jumping a lot. Huh? From 110, I've straight away gone to 1000. Tell me what happens for 1000. 1 plus 1 by 1000 raised to the power 1000. No. Aro, it'll not give you 1. Okay, so Ansh has given me 2.7169. Right? So Ansh, I'm assuming that your answer calculation is correct. Okay, now put 1 lakh. Okay, put 1 lakh. If at all you can. One lakh. 1 plus 1 by 1 lakh to the power of 1 lakh. Now I can see you have started realizing this figure, 2.78. So basically what will happen is, if you keep on increasing this x value, let's say if you take a very, very large value, let's say, you know, something like tending to infinity, okay, your e value is going to tend towards a value which we call as e, okay? Now, this type of notation you might have experienced while studying compound interest in maths, right? But as a science student, right, compound student interest may be an application for a commerce guy. As a science student, let me tell you, E has a very vital role to play. It is so useful for us that we are going to use it very, very widely in calculus. Okay. Now, where do you see E in nature? We see E in nature in the radioactive substances. Let me give you a brief idea about where do we see E. Normally, the radioactive substance that is there in nature, whether you talk about thorium or uranium, etc. Of course, yes, Kshitij, they're half-lives, okay? Now, these radioactive substances, they all decay, okay? And the rate at which they decay is given by, or the expression for the mass of the radioactive substance at a given time t is given by m0. M0 is basically the mass at t equal to 0, e to the power minus lambda t, where 1 by lambda is the average life of the radioactive substance. Okay. Normally, let's say, for example, there is a radioactive substance x, whose average life is, let's say, 5,000 years. Okay, let's say this X substance has an average life of 5,000 years. Okay. Now, what it says that in one 5,000 year, let's say if you started with 1 gram of X, in one 5,000 years, this substance will become 1 by E times its original weight. That means if you start with a 1 gram, it is going to become 1 by E gram. Okay, another 5,000 years, it's going to become, another 5,000 years is going to become 1 by E square gram. Okay, right? So this is how in nature we can see where does my E exist? Where does this irrational number E exist? Okay, and this has been figured out experimentally, okay, through accelerated mode. Now you must be thinking, oh, people waited for 5,000 years to see that. No, radioactive substances are decayed in an accelerated way. Okay, in reactors. And from there, they came to know that this is the rate at which they are decaying. Okay. Anyways, you are going to study more about it in a chapter called chemical kinetics. In a chapter called chemical kinetics, especially when you are studying first order chemical kinetics. First order chemical kinetics. I'm sure you're going to study that in class 11 itself. Gaurav sir is going to take your class on that. Okay, there your E is basically used. Okay, anyways, coming to the question, my dear friends. Treat as of now E being a number greater than 1. So 2.718-ish is the value of E. Okay, so let's plot this graph. So how will you first plot this graph? Let me again copy this. Mod Y, what was the graph? What was the function? Sorry, I forgot. Mod Y plus 3 is equal to e to the power mod x minus 1 plus 2. Okay. What is the skeleton graph you're going to start with? Anybody? Y is equal to e to the power x, obviously, correct? So the graph is going to look like this. So it's going to be, okay, sorry for drawing it in yellow. I should have drawn it in white because my function is written in white. Actually, one question I would like to ask you, okay? Let me take you back to GeoGebra. Okay, sorry, I forgot to ask you that. Let's say I plot y is equal to 2 to the power x. Okay, listen to my question very carefully. What will happen if I plot y is equal to 3 to the power x? Will it bend more or will it bend less? That is my question. Okay. Will it be like, you know, more bent like this? Okay. Sorry, I'm not drawing it here because it'll going to merge with that. Or is it going to be bent less like this? Okay. What will happen? Option A or option B? Let's have a quick poll. Okay. Just choose A or B. Do you think 3 to the power x is going to be shaped like A? Or is it going to be shaped like B? 30 seconds for that. 30 seconds, not more than that. Wonderful, wonderful. I'm getting phenomenal response from everybody. Not able to see the chat? Don't worry, you can type it out. Okay, Mriganka, we'll discuss. Last 3 seconds. 1, 2, 3. Everybody, please go on. Go on to vote. Okay. So 92% of you say A. Okay. The answer is yes, it is going to be A. Okay. So let me show the graph to you. Y is equal to 3 to the power x. Y is equal to 3 to the power x. Okay. As you can see, it is more bent as compared to 2 to the power x. Common sense, yeah? Common sense. Because at x equal to 1, the previous one will give you 2, but this blue one will give you 3. So for the same value of x as 1, now you are going to have a higher value, which is going to be 3. That's why it has to be more bent. So, you know, it's basically obvious that if you increase the value, it'll become more bent. If you decrease it, it becomes lesser bend, lesser bend, lesser bend, lesser bend, and it becomes a straight line like this when your A is 1. And if you decrease it further, it starts lifting it from this end. Okay, that is the transition. So E to the power X will be somewhere in between. Now, this is just for your understanding. You don't have to exactly, you know, sketch it. Sketching is just a rough estimation. So E to the power X is slightly in between this red and this blue graph. Okay, anyways. Any questions here? Parvati, never mind. It's okay. Even if you don't see the poll, you can just type your answer on the chat box privately to me. Okay, no worries. Now, what are the next step that you're going to do, my dear? Anybody, any suggestions from you, your side? Auro, which is the next step that you're going to take? Shitij is saying he is going to replace x with x minus 1. Then Shitij, tell me, how are you going to put a mod on x minus 1, dear? Good that you realize your mistake. And everybody who is saying x minus 1, I want, my dear students, you all to realize your mistake. If you put x as x minus 1, how are you going to put mod around it? Because mod can only be introduced with an x or a y. Okay. So, Mriganka, Oshik, you are absolutely correct, dear. You are now going to put your x as x plus 2. Okay, that's the next step. Of course, or we can do y as y plus 3 also. But let's take care of x part first. So if I'm doing that, my graph is going to just shift 2 units to the left, right? It's going to shift 2 units to the left. That means the same value I'm going to now realize at -2. So this value will, you know, come to this point. Okay, so your graph would look like this. Okay, now remember at 0, it will have attained a value of e square. So it is 0, e square now. Okay, anyways, next, what do you want to do? Now, of course, you will say, let's mod x first. Okay, so let's do that. Let me take a green sketch. So third step is let's do a mod of the x. Okay, modding x means whatever you have drawn in the positive side, drawn in the negative side, erase that off. Okay, so basically this part is going to be erased off. And whatever you have drawn on the positive side, that is going to get reflected about the y-axis. So more or less, this is how this structure is going to look like. Okay. Okay. Next is the fourth step. What is the fourth step? Anybody? Changing x with x minus one, right, Shitij? So I'm not going to make x as x minus one. So when I do that, everything goes 1 unit to the right. Okay. So your graph is going to appear like this. Okay. Basically, it's a kinky parabola. Kinky parabola means having a kink over here. Okay. It's not a smooth. It's just a kink. Okay. Next, what are you going to do? Next, if I were you, I would change my y to y plus 3. Okay. So fifth step. When I change my y to y plus 3, I have to bring everything down by 3 units. Remember e square, right now it is at 1, e square, right? E square is square of 2.7, right? Which I think conveniently will be like 7-ish, correct? So if you bring it down by 3, it's not going to go down in the negative side. So it's going to stop over here somewhat. Okay. Sorry for, you know, making it so cluttered, but I'm sure you can see my orange graph. Can you see my orange graph? Okay. Now finally, modding y. Modding y means whatever is below the x-axis, remove it. But there's nothing below the x-axis. Okay. And whatever is above the x-axis, you need to reflect it down. So your graph will look like this, my dear students. Let me draw it in the, you know, same color. It's going to appear like this. Ooh. Okay, so it will have a kinky parabola on top, kinky parabola below the x-axis. Can we just check this out? Mod y plus 3, I'm going to raise this off. Mod y plus 3 is equal to e raised to the power of absolute value of x minus 1. Okay. What else was required? Sorry, I forgot. X minus 1 plus 2, right? Okay. Plus 2. There you go. Okay. Let me just zoom in a bit. Okay. Please ignore the distortion in the figure. Okay, because you know GeoGebra is a very, very heavy software, so there is some distortion at times, so please ignore it. So basically it's like two kinky parabola, okay, like this and like this over here. Okay, when you start seeing that your GeoGebra is giving you trouble, switch to desmos.com. okay, that's also a very, very good online platform for sketching the graphs. Okay, so Auro is asking me to give some questions on GIF. Okay, Auro, let's have some exponential questions on GIF. Okay, let's, one more we'll have it. Sketch the graph of. Let's sketch the graph of y is equal to. 3 to the power x minus 1, okay, and let's make a curly bracket along x. Okay, let's make a curly bracket along x. Okay, and let's make a GIF around the whole thing. Okay, and let me mention also, this represents the fractional part. Fractional part, and this represents the greatest integer function. Now please note, never treat any bracket to be special bracket until unless stated. Until unless stated, don't start treating any square brackets or curly brackets to be special bracket. Of course, not in your assignments. In your assignments, I have probably not mentioned this, but in the assignment, all the square brackets are GIF, all the curly brackets are fraction part. Okay, let's try to attack this question. How will I do this? In fact, I will also, you know, struggle along with you. Let's solve it together. The first step that you're going to do is you're going to first plot 3 to the power x. Okay, 3 to the power x, we all know it's a graph like this. Okay, no problem with this graph. Any questions? Now, next that we are going to do is, let's say this was your first step. Second step is you're going to change your x with x minus 1. What happened when you do that? What happened when you do that? The entire graph shifts one unit to the right. So basically your graph will be like this. Okay. Is that fine? Okay. Next, what do you do? Next, what do you do? Next, what do you do? You are not taking a fractional part of x. What do you do when you're doing that? What are you doing when you're doing that? Basically, you are taking the part of this graph which is sandwiched between 0 and 1 and you are replicating it. Getting my point? So this part will be replicated everywhere. Okay. It's better to see it on a GeoGebra. Then it'll make more sense to you. Okay. So y is equal to 3 to the power of x minus 1. Okay, so this was your function, correct? Now let's replace your x with x minus, just give me a second, I'll just replace it with x minus floor x. Okay, this is what happens. This is what I was trying to talk about. Okay, so whatever is the part of the function which is trapped between 0 and 1 of the x, that is going to get repeated. Just recall, it was just done last class with you. Okay, now next, what do? We try to mod the, GIF the whole function. Okay, when we GIF the whole function, remember what was the approach? We used to make horizontal lines, right? We used to make horizontal lines at unit distance apart. So let me just zoom this a bit. Yeah. Okay. So basically you are going to make lines like y is equal to 1. Okay. But here if you see the first line itself has gone above, and whatever is below, whatever is sandwiched in these zones, they are all going to fall on the y-axis. So everything is going to fall down on the floor below it. So it's going to fall down on y equal to 0. It's going to all fall down on this line. I'm showing that with orange. So whatever is between y equal to 1 and y equal to 0 is going to fall on the floor below, as in it is all going to collapse and become a straight line. So that's what I think Kshitij was trying to say. Isn't it? Yes. Isn't it, Kshitij? This is what you wanted to say? Okay. Okay. So let me just do that also so that everybody is convinced that we are going the right way. So y is equal to floor of your p function. As you can see, the floor of p function is going to be right on the x-axis. That means it is going to match with the x-axis. So everything has gone. So it is going to be just a line like this. Just a line like this. Okay. Is that fine? Is this fine, everybody? Any questions? Any questions, anybody? Okay. Yeah, of course. There are going to be holes when it attains integer values. Okay. So 3 to the power, this minus 1, right? The moment it achieves the value of 1, those values are going to stay there. Okay. Right? That means when this guy, just a second. For this to be 1, this guy has to be 0. Correct? And for that to happen, this is going to be 1, which is not possible. So no, there will not be any holes. Very good question asked. There will not be any holes. There will not be any holes, Kshitij. Okay. Is that fine? Any questions? Okay. So with this, we are going to now launch ourselves to logarithmic functions. Guys, very, very important for the next 1 hour. I want everybody to pay attention. If possible, put down your pens and just listen. Okay. Don't worry about the class notes. It will be shared with you in the group. You can, you know, aram se sit and copy at home. Okay. Just listen to this. Logarithm is basically a function which was devised by John Napier. Okay. John Napier was the guy who gave us this type of functions. Okay. And this function is basically the inverse of what exponential function does. Okay, so we have just now learned y is equal to a to the power x, correct? Now, when I say exponential function, when I say logarithmic function, it is log of some quantity to the base of a, correct? This is the expression for a simple looking logarithmic function. That means, the meaning of this expression is x is a to the power of y. X is a to the power of y. The same thing is represented in a different form, which is y is equal to log x to the base of a. Okay, so both mean the same things. Both of these, they mean the same thing. So you may say that logarithm is doing what? The inverse of what exponential function is doing. Okay, I'll give an example. Let's say, if I say 5 to the power, let's say x, and I put x as 2, what value does y take up? Y takes up 25, correct? 5 to the power 2 is 25. If you feed 25 to a log as an argument of log, this is called the argument of log, with a base of 5, we are going to get back this input. That is how an inverse function behaves. Let me give you an idea about inverse of a function briefly, even though we are not going to talk in detail about it because it's a class 12 subject matter. See, I'll give you a simple example. Let's say there is a machine. Okay. This machine takes some input, okay, and it gives some output. Let's say I call this machine as the exponential or the function f, okay. Later on, I'll talk about exponential and all. And there's another machine okay. What it does, it takes the input that machine number f gives, okay. So let's say this is a machine which where you feed in, let's say, atta. Okay, and it gives you a chapati. Okay, so what does F machine do? It takes atta as an input side and gives you chapati. And if machine F inverse, if you feed chapati to it, it is going to give you back atta. Okay, then we say that these machines are playing inverses of each other. These machines are playing as inverses of each other. A typical example is sine x and sine inverse x, right? So if let's say this is sine x machine, then its inverse is your sine inverse x machine. Now, before I move on, there is a small clarification which I want to give everybody. The symbol minus one does not mean one by f, my dear. I know it's a human psychology to treat every term raised to the power of minus one as one by that term. Please note, now you will be introduced to something called linear algebra, where you will be learning how to find inverse of few elements. Now, inverse function is an aspect of linear algebra. It just means this function performs the inverse of what this function does. For example, sine x. Okay. In sine x, you know that if you feed 30 degree, what is the answer that you get? What is sine 30 degree, everybody? 1/2, correct? So inverse of this function, that is sine inverse, if you feed half, it will give back 30 degree to you. Just think it like this. So it takes the output of f to generate the input of f. Getting my point? The same way log also behaves. So log is the inverse of the exponential function. In fact, vice versa, both are inverses of each other, right? For example, what e to the power x will do, the inverse of that log x to the base e will do. Let's take an example. If I put x value as, let's say, 5, this will give me e to the power 5, correct? If you feed this in place of x over here, it is going to give you 5 back. It is going to give you 5 back. Okay. Now, before I go on to such exercises, many of you may not be very clear with this definition. So let me give you some illustrations. See, when you say log of x to the base a, it means what power will you raise on a to get x? Think like that. So if I say log 100 to the base 10, it means what number will you raise on 10 to get 100? That means which value of this question mark will satisfy this equation? Of course, answer is, this question mark here is 2, correct? So if I say log 64 to the base 4, it means which power will you raise on 4 to get a 64? What is the answer? Which power will you raise on 4 to get a 64? Everybody tell me. 3. Absolutely. Okay. So log 64 to the base 4 is 3. Understood how log behaves? Correct. Now you can know that it is actually behaving as the inverse of an exponential function. So this fellow is basically log x to the base 4. Okay. And it is behaving as inverse of 4 to the power x. Let me give you more examples. I want you to be very, very comfortable with this. Tell me what is log 1/27 to the base of 3. Just one person is answering. Very good, Gurman. Very good, Aro. So answer is -3. Very good. Okay. Now you've got a hold of it. Okay. Now let me ask you this. What is log, let me ask you like this, log 25 to the base of 1/5? -2, very good, very good. Okay, what is log 1 to the base of 1000? Excellent, 0, very good, very good. Okay, tell me, log -2 to the base of 5. I understand why you don't have clue, because we cannot find it. There is no such real numbers. This doesn't belong to any real number. We cannot figure out any real number which gives this answer. Okay, try this out. Log -2 to the base of 1. Again, no clue. There is no such number which you can raise on 1 to get a minus 2, right? See, why I'm asking you these questions for a certain reason. I'll tell you the reason in some time. Okay. Acha. Tell me, what value of this argument should be there such that x is real and it satisfies this criteria? Log of x to the base minus 1 is half. Tell me a real number which satisfies this criteria. Nothing, exactly. There is no real number like this, right? Because if you raise minus 1 to the power half, you end up getting an imaginary number. Okay, now the reason why I told you all these things is because, boys and girls, when you define a log function, there are certain restrictions. There are certain restrictions which we need to obey. Okay, what are those restrictions? Let me tell you first. Whenever you are defining a function log of f of x to some base g of x, okay, just for purpose of, you know, taking a general example, I've taken f of x and g of x, okay. There are two restrictions which log must obey. Number one, the argument of log must always be positive, not even zero. So whatever you're feeding to log, this is called the argument of the log. This is called the argument of the log. This is called the base of the log. The argument of this log must always be positive. We cannot feed negative. We cannot feed zero to log. Because if we do that, the same clueless situation will come in your mind for various values. For various values. I'm not saying for all values. Right? It's the same way, you know, that we had, you know, experience in case of exponential functions. Okay. So log of a negative number is not going to give you a real answer. Is not going to give you a real answer except for a few cases. Okay. So what the consortium decided was not to entertain any argument given to log which is less than zero or less than equal to zero also. So everything that you feed to log should be greater than zero. Okay. Second restriction that we normally put is on the base. Base is just like the number a in the exponential function. It is to be greater than zero and it cannot be one. And precisely, you have seen that in the previous example that we took, you were clueless about when I asked you what is log minus 2 to the base 1. Right? You were clueless about that x value when your base was no negative number. So we never ever entertain any inputs to the log function which is less than or equal to zero. We never keep the base of log function negative or equal to one. In fact, negative or equal to zero or equal to one. Okay. So these are the two restrictions that we need to abide by if we are defining a log function. This is very, very important. Do not forget it. Ansh has a question. Y is equal to a to the power x and written as x is equal to a to the power y. Okay, can we consider to just switching y and x? Ansh, you actually, you know, took away what I wanted to say in after a few minutes of my class. I actually exactly wanted to convey the same thing. I was just waiting for people to understand log first, then the graph of it, and then come to this property. Okay. Yeah, Shitish has a question. Sir, if the base is negative, argument can be negative. Argument can be negative, right? No, again, the same problem will come. It will selectively work. Shitish, it will selectively work. It will work for some values. It will not work for many, many values. That's why, in order to avoid that complexity, we removed it altogether. I understand your concern. For example, you may want to write log minus 1 to the base of minus 1 as, let's say, 3. Right? You want to write, right? But again, there will be several other values which we will not be able to address. Okay? So if this number here doesn't have, let's say, or have, you know, an even number in the base, it will become very difficult to, for us to answer such cases. Okay? I understand your dilemma. I understand your concern regarding this, but unfortunately we don't entertain such situations. Yes, when your base is one, the only value that you entertain is one. Okay, because 1 to the power 1 is going to be one. So only for that one particular value it will work, Shubhi. Okay, so we are not going to, you know, change the rules for these bits and pieces values that are going to be real in nature. So we just stick to this strong, you can say, restriction on the log function. Okay, if you want to see your log as real valued. If you want to see your log as a real valued function, we must abide to these two important constraints on the function. Okay. Now talking something about the base. Okay. Talking something about the base. Normally we deal with two types of bases. We deal with the base E, which we have already discussed about 2.718, etc. Log with the bases E are called natural logs. Okay. We also call it as the Napierian logarithm, after the name of John Napier. Okay. Mostly you'll see that in calculus, we use log to the base E. Now, all of you, please pay attention here. In calculus, if you realize, let's say tomorrow you are studying some calculus concept and you just see a log X, without any base. Don't get surprised if there is no base, that means the base is E. Okay. In calculus, if they just say log X, it is to be read as log X to the base E. Okay. In the pronunciation sense, we call it as ln X, right? Written also as ln X, ln X. Okay. The other type of base that we normally deal with is the base of 10. Okay. And log to the base 10 are called common logarithms. Common logarithms. Okay. Many a times it is called the Brixian. The Brixian logarithm. After the name of Henry Briggs. He was an English mathematician. It's named after Henry Briggs. Okay, so Brixian logarithm, basically you will find in your log tables. Okay, Clark log table is available in the market. You can also find an online soft version of that. So when we are doing certain kind of calculations in maths, or for that matter in chemistry, we'll be using log tables, and that log table is actually written in the base of 10. So we follow Brixian logarithm there. So this guy gave a different nature to the log function that originally John Napier had discovered. Now, when we talk about these two bases, there is a formula which converts log to the base E to log to the base 10. The formula is log to the base E, let's say log of X to the base E, is 2.303 times log X to the base 10. This is a very important formula that will help you to convert log to the base 10 to base E and vice versa. Okay. Now there are a few values that I would like you to remember also. Log 2 to the base 10, this value is 0.3010. Okay. Now guys and girls, please listen to this very carefully. For any competitive exams, you are not allowed to use calculators. Okay. So if at all, I mean, I know you have not been using calculator for your junior classes also, but if at all you are a person who has a habit to, you know, grab a calculator or grab a mobile phone for doing such calculations, please stop it. Please stop it right now. If you have a calculator in your house, whether it is scientific or non-scientific, ask your parents to keep it away from you. Ask your siblings to keep it away from you. You are not allowed to use calculators except for one part B of KVPY exam, and that too calculator which is present on the computer. That is what you can use. But for all preparations, whether it's your CBSE board exams or whether it's for your, you know, any competitive exam in India, no calculator is allowed. Another value that I would like you to remember is log 3 to the base 10, which is 0.4771, roughly. Okay. So just a question for you all. If log 2 is this, what is ln 2? If log 2 to the base 10 is 0.3010, what is ln 2? Fast. Give the answer to three significant figures without using calculator. To three significant figures. Just a simple calculation. What is ln 10 also? That's correct, Shitij. 0.693. Very good. Very good. What is ln 10? Ln 10, you should tell me in 1 second only. 2.303. Is it? If you put 10 over here, ln 10 will become 2.303 into log 10 to the base 10, which is 1 only. Correct, Shitij. Why 2.71? Okay. So with this, we are going to now see the graph of log functions. Okay. Now remember, I talked about the base, right? So we are talking about log x to the base, let's say a. So we know that the base has this restriction, just like the exponential function had the restriction. So this actually divides the graph into, or we can say it divides the concept into two different cases. One where your a is between 0 and 1, and other where your a is greater than 1. So let's talk about these two types of bases. Remember, the graph nature will be different in both the cases. Let's take, for example, a base which is half, just for, you know, plotting purpose, just for knowing the, you know, skeleton graph of such cases. Remember, yeah, you can take any value between 0 and 1, the structure or the skeleton would more or less remain the same. Okay. Now, when we don't know the value of, when we don't know the skeleton graph of something, we mostly rely on plotting it. Okay, so let's plot it. So let me just ask you a few questions. Yeah, I think more than sufficient we have. Tell me, what is the value of y when x is 1? Fast. I will not give you more than 5 seconds for every question I ask. Value of y when x is 1. Value of y when x is 1. 0. Very good. Okay. Tell me the value of y when x is half. 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 1. Absolutely. Value of y when x is 1/4. 2. Very good. Value of y when x is 2. Very good. Value of y when x is 4. Minus 2. Very good. Okay. So we have enough number of data points to plot the graph of log x to the base of something which is between 0 and 1. Okay. So the first thing is the graph is passing through 1, 0. Now this is something very important, my dear students. Please remember this. We had a very similar trend seen in the exponential. In exponential, if you recall, the graph was passing through 0, 1. Here it is passing through 1, 0. Now slowly start comparing those two graphs. Then I'll ask you the final verdict from your side. Next, when x is half, y is 1. So basically, you are at this stage. When x is 1/4, y is 2. So you are at this stage. When x is 2, y is minus 1. So you are at this stage. When x is 4, y is minus 2. You are at this stage. So we have enough number of points. Let's see how the graph looks like. Tuck, 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 tuck. Okay, just. Okay. Yeah. Sorry for this freehand drawing, but this is going to be just smooth. And this is how your graph actually looks like. Okay. Remember, it is going indefinitely in both the directions. So put arrows. Now, other comparison that you would see is that this graph will have y-axis as the asymptote. Now, dear friends, let me tell you, y-axis is the asymptote only for log x to the base of half. Okay? Or log x to the base of any number between 0 and 1. If you change your x, asymptote is going to shift. Right? Many of us have a very wrong notion about asymptote. We think that asymptotes are immovable structure. No. No. Asymptotes can move. Okay? So if I say log x minus 2 to the base half, then the graph will move 2 units to the right. In that case, x equal to 2 will be your vertical asymptote. Okay? Right? Okay. Now, again, there is a very, very stark resemblance, between the exponential curve and the logarithmic curve in this case. Okay, let me complete the entire process and then we'll make a final, comparison of the graph and see how can the graph of exponential function and logarithmic function be related to each other. Okay, and another thing that I would like to highlight over here is that the graph will never ever touch the y-axis. But as your x tends to infinity, y will go to minus infinity. Okay, so please remember this nature of the graph. Now coming to a case where your base is greater than 1. Again, for example, we can take a simple case, log x to the base of 2. Okay, again, I've taken 2 for simplicity. Okay. Acha, I'll ask a question after this little later on. Let's plot this. So for that, I need some sample values. Let's have some sample values. Okay. Let's have x, y. Again, what is y when x is 1? Quick. Let me take it here. Absolutely. What is y when x is 2? 1. What is y when x is half? Minus 1. Very good. What is y when x is 1/4? Minus 2. Very good. Okay. In fact, 1/8, it will be minus 3. Okay. Now, let's try to plot this graph as well. And you can see, just like the previous graph, this graph will also pass through this point 1, 0. Okay. And as I increase the value, let's say 2, it will become 1. Okay. 4, it would have gone at 2. Okay. 1/2, it becomes minus 1. 1/4, it becomes a minus 2. 1/8, it becomes minus 3. And when you plot it, this is what you see. Okay. Again, y-axis is behaving as the asymptote. Okay. And again, the asymptote is going to change if you change the input function, if you change your argument of the function. And you can see here is that when x is going to infinity, y will also go towards infinity. Okay. Now, dear friends, I would like you to see this on the GeoGebra as well. Let's appreciate this on GeoGebra as well. So in GeoGebra, you can actually choose your base. See, there is a function log. If you type, it will prompt you. Okay, the first of this function, you can see here, you can choose the b value and you can also choose your argument. So let's say if you choose a half as b and let's say x as the argument, this is how the graph will look like. Okay. Okay. Now I have a question for all of you. How would this graph change if I change my base to, let's say, 1/4? Will it bend more or will it bend less? That means, will the graph look like this? Or will the graph look like this? Okay. Let's say I give you the option. Option A, option B. Let me switch on the poll button. Okay, in case you're not able to see the poll, please type it out. Will it be more bent or will it be less bent? Oh my God, 50-50 response. Okay, last 10 seconds. Please conclude your voting in the next 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Everybody, please vote. 4 of you are still not voted. Okay. Do you see that response? Can you see my reaction? Exactly 50-50 voting has come. Okay. We did it. Okay, guys. So see, common sense. If you apply your common sense, you can resolve this issue very easily. Okay. You're talking about these two functions, log x to the base half and log x to the base 1/4. Okay. If I were you, I would choose a value of x, let's say 4. Okay. Now you know that log 4 to the base 1/4 will give you a minus 1. Whereas log 4 to the base half will give you a minus 2. Correct? Yes or no? Okay. So log 4 to the base of 1/4 will give you a higher value as compared to log 4 to the base half. Now this is already log 4 to the base half. So option A must be the right option. The graph will bend more. The graph is going to bend more. Okay. Let's see that. Y is equal to log 1/4 of x. See, it has bent more. Okay. So more lesser you go, that means you are going towards zero, more bending it will show. Okay. And more you go towards one, let's say if you take 3/4, it will less bend less. Correct. And you would realize that exactly at one, it will become a vertical shape. Okay. So see, y is equal to log. If you take, let's say 7/8x, see, it will bend less. Okay. And let's say if you make it one by any chance, let's say log to the base 1, which actually we don't entertain. Okay. That's why it is not giving you any results for it. Or you make it very, very close. Let me make it as 0.999999 kind of a thing. Okay. It'll almost become a vertical line. Okay. So again, just like the exponential function, from more bent, it will become less bent, less bent, less bent. It will become vertical and then it'll start bending this way. Now I'll show you what happens when you do log x to the base of 2. Okay. So it has now bent the other way. So appreciate the transition. See, the transition is like this, my dear. From this bend, the bend will start becoming lesser. And at one stage, it will become vertical. And after this, the bend will go this way. Getting the point? Just like in the exponential function. Earlier, the bend was like this. Then it became flat. And then it started bending the other way. Okay, that is what you need to appreciate. Okay. Now, another thing that is the most important part for us is if you compare the exponential and the logarithmic functions, if you compare the exponential and the logarithmic graph, see what will happen. Let me draw these two graphs on the same XY axis. Okay. Let me draw the same graph. 2 to the power X graph, as you all know, it's a graph like this. Okay. And log X to the base 2 would be a graph like this. Okay. If you see very closely, you would realize, I think a little while ago, somebody was pointing this out. These two graphs are like mirror images about this red line, which is basically your y equal to x line. Okay. It is mirror image about y equal to x line. Right? Do you realize that? Should I show you correct or let me show you on the Desmos, on the GeoGebra tool as well. Let me remove this. It is too muddled up. I'll pick up a new instance. Y is equal to 2 to the power x and y is equal to log x to the base 2 and y is equal to x. See, appreciate. Look at the graph, how symmetrically they are placed. If you want, I can show the mirror image about y equal to x. Reflect object about this line. Okay, you can see it is exactly overlapping with this. So even if I switch off the log x to the base 2 graph, it doesn't change. And if I switch it on, both are overlapping on each other. You can see them. I'm switching it on and off. Okay. This is something which is a very, very important revelation for us. It tells you that when you want to have the positions of x and y swapped, see what is happening. Y is equal to 2 to the power x and y is equal to log x to the power base 2, which is indirectly saying x is 2 to the power y. Basically, if you see these two, you can notice that the x and the y values are swapped. X and y positions are swapped. Okay. So when you are swapping the position of x and y in any function, you now know what to do with them. You just have to reflect the one about y equal to x to get the other one. Okay. So this is another rule that I would like you to add to your rule list, that if let's say y is equal to f of x graph is given. Graph is given. Okay. And somebody wants to plot the graph of x equal to f of y, then what do you do? Right? Then what do? This graph is obtained by, let's say I call this as 1, is obtained by reflecting the graph of 1 about y equal to x line. Right? It's a very, very important tool, because many a times what happens, when we see a question, we sometimes feel that, oh, had x and y positions been interchanged, I would have easily plotted the graph. When such kind of feelings start coming in you, it basically, this particular rule is going to help you in that regard. Yes, Kshitij, that's what I wanted to say. The graph of a function and its inverse will be mirror images of each other about y equal to x line. This is something which you are going to study next year in the functions chapter. But if you know it now itself, nothing like that. Okay. So on this rule, I'm going to ask you a simple question. Sketch the graph of x equal to y square minus 3y plus 2. Okay. Yes, Ansh. So what I said was, in any function, if you are swapping the position of x and y, okay, and you want to know the graph of this new function obtained, for example, let's say this was the original function, and you swap the position of x and y to get this, and you want to obtain the graph of this, all you need to do this, you take this graph and reflect it about y equal to x line. Your job is done. Understood the rule, Ansh? Oh, inverse one. So see, this fellow is the inverse of this fellow. Okay. Y is equal to f of x, right? And x equal to f of y. These two functions are inverses of each other. Okay. So what Kshitij was saying, that if you want to get the graph of inverse of any function, you just have to reflect that function about y equal to x line. Same thing. Okay, but let me tell you, the inverse concept is not as simple as that, you know, atta and chapati example that I gave you. There are a lot of restrictions that we need to exercise. Not every function in this world is invertible. Okay, a function, in order to be invertible, must be a bijective function. What is a bijective function, etc., etc.? As of now, you will not understand it. We'll talk about it when the right time comes. As of now, my immediate question to all of you is, sketch this graph. Sketch the graph of x is equal to y square minus 3y plus 2. Done? Is it done? Okay. So now, whenever you see such kind of a question, the first thing that comes in your mind, oh, how I wish x and y positions were interchanged, right? Okay, so don't worry, interchange them. Okay, get this simple looking graph. We all can plot it. It's basically an upward looking parabola. Okay, and it basically cuts the x-axis at 1 and 2, right? We all know it's factorizable, right? We all know it's factorizable as x minus 1, x minus 2. Okay, now how do we change the position of x and y? How do we plot x equal to y square minus 3y plus 2? So first you need to, you know, understand that we have to reflect such graph about this line. Okay, so we need to reflect it about this line. Okay, I'm making it dotted because this is not a part of our graph. It is just a, you know, mirror for us as of now. Okay, now how would I reflect this? Now guys, let me tell you, many of us are blessed with this, you know, capability to imagine the reflection. Many of us can sketch it, you know, without much problem. Okay, I, as a student, I was not blessed with this capability. I found it extremely hard to reflect any graph about y equal to x line. Okay, and I assume most of you may be also feeling that same pain. Okay, we are not that, you can say, artistic kind of people that looking at it we can reflect it. No, even I was a person and I felt, you know, miserable when, you know, somebody asked me to reflect graph about y equal to x sine. But I never gave up. I figured out a mechanism to reflect any function about y equal to x line. And I would like now to share that, you know, method or mechanism with you, so that if at all you are a person who is not able to imagine reflections about, you know, oblique lines, you can, when I say oblique line, I mean y equal to x line, you can use that methodology to, you know, achieve your task. So what I followed was this method. Okay, listen to this method very carefully. So let's say I have a question here that I want to reflect this white parabola about this yellow line, about y equal to x line. Okay. So first thing, what I used to do was, I used to first reflect it about x axis, reflect the graph about x axis. Okay. So what I used to do is, I used to tear a very small piece of paper, or I used to use my eraser, white color, big eraser used to come that time. Okay. I used to draw the reflection of this graph. I'll show you how I used to do it. So let's say this is a small piece of paper. Okay. Let's say this is a paper which I have torn from the back of my book. And I used to just draw the reflection of this graph, very small graph. I'll make like this. Okay. Okay. This is my step number one. See, reflecting about x-axis is always easy. Right, there's no problem with that, because you can see, okay, this part will go up, these two arms will come down like this. So reflecting about a horizontal or a vertical line is always easy. Okay, reflecting about oblique line is challenging. That's what I'm trying to address over here. Now the second step, what I used to do is, okay, I used to rotate this paper, this piece of paper, I used to rotate it 90 degrees anti-clockwise. Okay, I used to rotate it 90 degrees anti-clockwise. And when I used to do that, whatever figure I used to get, see this paper, I just, you know, rotate it like this, such that my x-axis becomes y-axis, okay? And whatever graph I used to get, for example, in this case, you'll end up getting a graph. You'll end up getting a graph like this. Okay? This used to be your final answer. This graph is going to be your final answer. Okay? So people who are not able to imagine reflection about y equal to x line can use my method. Now, later on, I came to know the reason for this, you know, why this method actually worked. Okay? Now, Kshitij, you're saying, wow, right? You will explain me why this method is working. You have learned all the rules, right? And trust me, when I learned this, I never knew these rules which I'm going to teach, which I'm teaching you right now. Yes, when you rotate it 90 degree Ansh, you are making x-axis as y-axis and you're making y-axis as negative x-axis. Now, anybody, not only Kshitij, sorry for taking your name, Kshitij, but it is an open question to everybody. Tell me, when I am going from y is equal to f of x to x equal to f of y, how does these two steps help me to achieve that? You can unmute yourself and talk. Anybody? Gurman? Arabi? Arya Dilip? Auro? Meganga, Muskan, Oshik, Pradyun, Parvati, Rubhav, Shubhi, Priyam, Pradyun. No, Arya Dilip, my question to you is, why these two steps convert this graph to this graph? That is my question. Okay, see, what did I do in step number one? I reflected the graph about x-axis, correct? Now you tell me, when you reflect a graph about x-axis, whose sign are you changing? Y sign you're changing, correct? So when you did the first step, my dear, you actually converted this guy to this guy, correct? Yes or no? Okay. Second step is what? Second step is you're rotating the graph 90 degree anti-clockwise. 90 degree anti-clockwise, just now I told Ansh that you are making your x-axis as the y-axis and y-axis as negative x-axis, right? So x-axis becomes your y-axis and y-axis becomes your negative x-axis. So if you make that change over here, your y will be replaced with an x. Sorry, your y will be replaced with a minus x and your x will be replaced with a y, correct? If you simplify this, don't you end up getting x equal to fy? That is what I was wanting. That is what I was looking for, isn't it? That's why this rule worked. And trust me, I did not know this for at least a month. Okay, when somebody, you know, taught me about these rules, then I correlated, okay, what I did really worked. Okay, and then it also struck me that if I reflected it about y-axis and rotated it clockwise, then also I can get the answer. Isn't it? Okay. So if you reflect, there's another method, method number two. If you reflect it about y-axis, reflect this graph about y-axis, then actually what are you doing? You are changing the sign of x, correct? And second step is, when you rotate the graph 90 degree clockwise, what are you doing? See, when you change, when you rotate such a graph, let's say 90 degree clockwise, you are making y come in place of x, correct? You are making y come in place of x and you are making x come in place of minus y. Correct? And there you go. We end up getting the same graph once again. Okay. So even this rule works. So whatever suits you, you can do it. And trust me, it is a universal rule. You can apply it to any function where you want to reflect that function about y equal to x line. It works. It really, really works. You'll really feel the need of this in a next year topic called inverse trigonometric functions. Inverse trigonometric functions, we will recall such rules. Okay, that's why we are dealing with this now only in the bridge course. Okay, that time I will not teach you, I'll directly ask you the rules. Okay, next thing that we are going to talk about, my dear students, are the properties of logarithms. Again, let me tell you, it's very unfortunate that CBSC has designed maths curriculum in a very, very weird way. You have to deal with log functions at every stages. You'll be dealing with log function in calculus. You'll be dealing with log function in coordinate geometry. You'll be dealing with log function in, you know, so many places. But there has not been a single dedicated chapter on log. Okay? I don't think so any one of you would have studied log in class 10th. Have you? Has anybody studied log in class 10th? Of course, in Pearson book you have studied. But NCRT syllabus, have you studied log? Not in school syllabus. And they expect you, the moment you enter your school premises in class 11, they'll expect you to know log also. Correct? So it is very important that we need to learn these concepts in the bridge course, because we'll not get any other opportunity to learn them. Okay? So having introduced the graph to you, having introduced the restrictions of log to you, now the third thing which is obviously left is your properties of log. Let's talk about them. The first property that many of us, you know, do not know about log, even the class 12th students make a mistake in this. If you have log of a quantity m to the base a whole raised to the power of a, the answer to this is, any guesses? Very good, Kshitij. M. Okay. This particular identity is called the fundamental logarithmic identity. This is called the fundamental logarithmic identity. And you'll be surprised that many of your seniors would also they forget this particular identity. Why it is called fundamental logarithmic identity? Because it comes directly from the definition of log itself, right? When I prove it, you'll come to know why it is coming from the definition. So let's prove it quickly. Let's say I call log m to the base a as x. Okay. So let log m to the base a be x, right? It means m is a to the power x. It comes from the very basic definition of log, correct? And what is x itself? X itself is this term. So I can say m is equal to a to the power log m to the base a. Okay. So this property is very important. You'll find this property used in several stages. I've seen many questions on integration also. In order to make it complicated, they use these log properties. Second property of log is, log actually converts products into sum. This property, I'm sure many of you would be knowing. And this is a property which is widely used in calculations. Okay. See, why it is used in calculations is because, go back at least 10 years down your line. You will recollect, even you can ask your parents, that the first operation that you would have learned in maths is addition. Okay. Any child, after counting, the first operation he learns is to add things. He never learns multiplication. He never learns division. Okay. So multiplication comes very late in our, you know, course, right? So we as humans are more comfortable doing addition, right? Our human mind is more, you can say, designed to do addition faster as compared to multiplication. So this is what log facilitates us. It converts multiplication, as you can see, it converts multiplication to addition. And that's why it finds its uses in log, in calculations. The moment we start having physical classes, I'll teach you how to see log tables also, how to read characteristic and mantissa. And this is an extensible property. You can extend it to, let's say, m, n, p. So it will become log m to the base a, log n to the base a, log p to the base a. provided these logs are all defined. Okay, so you can extend this to any number of product. Now, how do we prove it? Prove is very simple. In the interest of time, I'll be proving it. See, if you want to prove it, you can start from the RHS side. You can take log m to the base a as x. So let's call this as x. Okay, and let's call this as y. Log n to the base a as y. Okay, this means m is a to the power x. This means n is a to the power y. Correct. Let's multiply it. Let's multiply these two. When you multiply these two, means you are multiplying a to the power x and a to the power y. Now, I'm sure we all know exponential laws. Class 7th onwards, we have been studying exponential laws. Correct. So when the bases are same, we know powers get added up. So this is as good as saying log of mn to the base a is x plus y. And your x and y are basically those log m to the base a and log n to the base a. And hence, these properties are true. Any question with respect to this? Very, very simple property. In a similar way, which property number was this? 3, na? Okay. In a similar way, if you're dividing two quantities, even log will help you there. It converts them to subtraction. Again, we know that we have done subtraction in our life earlier than we had learned division. Okay. So this is again useful in calculations. Useful in calculations. Okay. Again, the proof is very similar, so I'm not going to waste your and my time doing the proof. Next is log m to the power n to the base a is n log m to the base a. Okay. Can you prove this property? Anybody? I'm giving you a minute. Please try it out on your notebook. Prove this property where n can be any real number. Okay, it need not be a natural number. It can be any real number. Your n can be any real number. Of course, subject to the fact that all these functions are well defined in real terms. Try to prove it. Okay, Shitish, very good. Anybody else who could prove it? Okay. In the interest of time, I'm going to help you with this. Let's say log m to the base a is x. That means m is a to the power x. Yes or no? Okay. Let's raise both the sides to the power of n. Now, we all know it is as good as saying a to the power nx, correct? Now that you have got m to the power n as a to the power nx, okay? It is as good as saying, by definition of log, that this to the base a is nx, and x itself is log m to the base a. Remember, x is this term, correct? And there you go. We are done. Okay. Now, many people tell me, sir, why to do this? Couldn't we write log m to the power n as m into m into m into m n times? Okay. Now, please note, this is, I can understand your intentions are right over here, but it will not work if n is not a natural number. It is fine when n is a natural number. Okay. Then you can say it is as good as writing log m to the base a n times. So you're writing log m to the base a m times by the previous, I think property number two, we did that. And it is as good as n times log m to the base a. But remember, this type of approach will only work when your n was a natural number. This is a generic approach. It can work for any n value. Okay. Next property is, which was this property number four. Next property is, log m, now this time the base is raised to the power n. This time the base is raised to the power n. It is given as 1 by n log m to the base a. Okay. Again, in the interest of time, I'll be proving this quickly. It'll not take much time. Okay. So let's say I take log m to the base a as x. Okay. Which means m is a to the power x by the very definition of log. Okay. I can also write this as a to the power n raised to the power of x by n. Right. So I did nothing. I just put n power on a and divided by n. So more or less n and n will get cancelled. And it is as good as writing this term. Okay, I can do that. Now, from the very definition of log, we can say log of m to the base of a to the power n will be x by n, which is nothing but 1 by n times x. X itself is log of m to the base a. And there you go. Done. Hence proved. Okay, so please note that you may get both the property number 4 and 5 together also sometimes. Okay, so be aware of that. Property number 6 is what we call as the change of base property. Change of base property. So listen to this property. This property is very, very useful property. Meanwhile, any questions? Oh yeah, sure. I'm going back to the previous screen once. I think Ansh wants to note down something. Yeah. Let me know, Ansh, once you're done. Okay, Ansh. Dear students, many a times I forget to look at the chat. Okay, so in case you find that sir is not responding to your question, please speak out that time. Okay, so please interrupt me. Feel free to interrupt me. Yeah, what is change of base property? It says log m to the base n could be written as log m to the base a by log n to the base a, where a is basically any base suitable for you to evaluate it. Okay. For example, let's say if I want to evaluate what is log, let's say 81 to the base of 27. Okay. Normally, to answer such questions, if you try to go to your power tables, let's say 27 to the power 0, 27 to the power 1, 27 to the power 2, you will realize that 81 will not appear in those power tables. So how do we tackle these kind of questions? So what we do is we choose a number on whose power both 81 and 27 appear. So I think that number is 3, correct? It could have been other numbers also. That depends upon how convenient you are. Some people may take 9 also, okay? So just take a number on whose power you think 81 and 27 both can appear. So you can write this as 81 to the base of 3, log 27 to the base of 3. Now, these numbers you can easily evaluate. This is 4, this is 3. So the answer is going to be 4 by 3. Not only in this cases, but also in case of calculus, you will realize that in calculus, you will be only told the derivative of ln x or ln x. And the question setter may ask you the derivative of the common log x. In those cases, you have to change the base and solve the question. How, we'll discuss when we learn derivatives. Don't worry about it. But this property is very, very important. And a derived format of this property is log m to the base n when multiplied to log n to the base m. This will always give you a 1, right? How, it's very simple. If you see the left hand side, you can write this as log m to the base b by log n to the base b. Similarly, this term you can write it as log n to the base b by log m to the base b, and you can cancel off these terms giving you a 1, right? Which actually means that if you flip the position of the base and the argument, it gives you reciprocal of that log. This is a very important property. Very, very important property. If you flip the position of the base and the argument, it will give you reciprocal of that. For example, let's say log 4 to the base 2 is 2, then log 2 to the base 4 is going to be half. Right? I don't have to tell you why. Okay. Any questions with respect to change of base property? Okay. The next property is m to the power of log n to the base a is same as n to the power of log m to the base a. That means if you swap the position of m and n, nothing happens. Nothing happens. The result is still the same. I'll show you an example. Log 4 to the power of 8 to the base 2 is same as 8 to the power of log 4 to the base 2. You can check how. This is 4 to the power of 3, right? Log 8 to the base 2 is 3 only, correct? Which is 64. And this is 8 to the power 2. Log 4 to the base 2 is 2, right? So this is also 64. So that gives you the same result. But this is about verifying it. Can you prove it? Yes, Aurav, that's correct. Can you prove it? Okay, I'll just quickly prove for you because, you know, I have to give you two problems also and we need to start calculus before the break. See, it's very simple. I'll give you a proof for this. Let's say log m to the base a is x and log n to the base a is y. This means a to the power x is m. This means a to the power y is n. Okay. Now, anybody can guess that this is going to be a correct expression. Correct? Because ultimately the power of a will be xy eventually. Correct? Right? So we all know that this is true. Okay. Now, what is a to the power x? A to the power x is m. Y is what? Y is log n to the base a. Right? So this is equal to a to the power y, which is actually your n, and x is what? This is your x, okay, which is log m to the base, and therefore this property, hence proved. Okay, so please remember, whenever you have to solve few questions where you feel like flipping the position of this m and n, you can very well do it. So now if you have understood these properties, I would like all of you to solve a question for me. Okay. By the way, log assignment has been uploaded on the bridge course. Okay, I'll send you the snapshot of where it is so that you can go and take it tonight after the class if you want. But let's have a question. I would like you to evaluate this. Okay, log of under root of 3 minus root 5 plus under root of 3 plus root 5 to the base 10. Okay, if you want, I can give you options also. And your options are half, 1 fourth, 3 by 2, 3 by 4. I will switch on the poll. Okay, after you're done, please press on the poll button. 2 minutes for this, time starts now. So it's almost going to be a minute. One more minute. Nobody has voted so far. Of course, you're not allowed to use log tables. You're not allowed to use calculators. So how do you solve this?
Okay, I can see one of you has responded. Last 15 seconds, my dear. Okay, 2 minutes are done. Two of you have voted so far. Now, I'm giving you another 10-second grace. I want everybody to press on the poll button. Don't worry, I don't come to know who has pressed on what poll button. Okay, just press on the poll button so that we can discuss it. Fine? Okay, at the count of five, I will end the poll. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. All right. So now maximum of Janta has gone for C option. Okay. This is the result. Okay. Then 14% each for A and B and no vote for D. Okay. Let's see what is the answer. See, first of all, if you see this expression, okay, I'll write it down again for you. Okay, let's multiply and divide with a root 2. Now, many people ask, sir, how do you come to know about these steps? See, when I see under root of something, I want to make it a perfect square. Okay, I want to make the inside term as a perfect square because I want to get rid of this under root symbol. Now, since I see a root 5, correct? That means one of the expressions was root 5. And the other expression has to be 1, and this root 2 will help me realize this. For example, if I multiply with root 2, it will make it root 6 minus 2 root 5. And here also 6 plus 2 root 5. Okay. Now you can see that this expression over here is under root of root 5 square 1 square minus 2 into 1 into root 5. That's how you end up getting 6 minus 2 root 5. In a similar way, this expression is under root of root 5 square, 1 square, 2 into 1 into root 5. Getting the point? Now, when I do that, I can easily break up this under root and write it as root 5 minus 1. And this term will be again root 5 plus 1 by root 2. Okay? So, is it clear the transition from this step to this step? Any question? So the quantity within the under root symbol was actually a perfect square. So square and perfect square, right? They gave me a mod of that quantity, but root 5 minus 1 is a positive, so mod was removed. Now remember, guys, this is a very important step which many people mistake. When you're taking out some square from an under root sign, it'll come out as mod x. So ideally, I should have written it like this, right? Please keep, you know, this in mind. This is something which is very, very essential. It may make a difference between you getting the answer right or wrong. Right? Let me tell you, it may make a difference between you getting the answer right or wrong. Okay? Why is it root 2? See, root 2 actually helped me to complete a square inside those under root terms. Getting my point, Mriganga? Root 2 was an agent that helped me to complete a square, because when I introduce a root 2, that 2ab thing comes into picture. Correct? And thankfully, 6 is basically square of root 5 plus square of 1. That's why this root 2 is introduced. Don't worry, you'll come to know about all these minor tricks as you solve more and more questions. I don't think so. In this case, Anusha, there would be another way to figure out how to do that. It's because I had, you know, I'm talking from a teacher's point of view. From a student point of view, if I have to give an opinion, it's only when you see many expressions of these types, then you'll be able to see that, oh, this expression was actually a perfect square. So you have to get exposed to more and more questions. Okay. Yes. How do we further solve this? That's what I'm doing, Ansh. So when you have this term, remember mod becomes immaterial over here because both these quantities are positive. So one and one goes off. So it have 2 root 5 by root 2, which is nothing but root of 10. Okay. So ultimately what you see here is that you have been asked to evaluate log of root 10 to the base 10. Correct? And we already know one of the properties that this power can be brought in front. So it becomes log 10 to the base 10, and that's half. That means option number A is correct. Option number A is correct. Okay. So well done to those who answered with A. Any questions here? Other than the fact that how do we come to know? See, maths is very, very unconventional. Maths is like, you know, trying to reach the result from right to left, not from left to right. Right? It becomes very abstract at times. There is no fixed methodology that will help you get the result. You have to be a lateral thinker. You have to be an unconventional thinker. It's not like physics that, oh, you apply Newton's law of motion, or you conserve momentum, you conserve energy, you write that momentum equation or torque equation, you get your answer. No, it doesn't work like that. When we start doing, you know, advanced level stuff towards the, you know, next to next year May, so not next to next year May, you'll realize that there can be problems which will blow your mind. You'll be like forced to think, how can a problem setter think like that? Okay. Welcome, this is maths for you. One more question I would like to take up before we go for a break. Okay. Evaluate Okay, this goes all the way till infinity. The base here is 9/4. Options are -2, -1, -2, -1/4. Guys, don't be scared, okay? Don't be scared. It is not that difficult as it appears to be. It's an infinite series. 1/2√3, √6 − 1/2√3, again √6 − 1/√3, again. So basically you are, you know, continuing the process on and on for infinite terms. Let's have 2 minutes. Exactly at 6 p.m. I'll discuss it, and then we'll take a break. And on the other side of the break, calculus is waiting for you. Once you're done, also please press on the poll button so that I know what is your response. It's already 6, but I'm going to give you 30 seconds more. Only three of you have voted so far. So I'm going to give you another 15 seconds. Please, everybody, please vote irrespective of whether you have solved it or not. Let's vote and then we'll discuss it. So in another 5 seconds, please finish off the voting. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go, go, everybody. Okay, let's end the poll here. This is the result. Maximum Janta thinks B. Maximum Janta thinks B. Okay, let's see whether B was correct or not. Okay, I think all of you got intimidated by this expression, right? See, this is not a new thing to you, right? Remember in your class 10th, you used to get this question, right? Evaluate root of 6 minus root of 6 minus root of 6 minus root of 6, right? Remember you used to get such expressions? What you used to do in those cases? Go back just a couple of months. You used to call this expression as x, and from the part where the expression used to get repeated, you used to replace it with x again, right? So you should treat it as x is under root of 6 minus x. Something like this you should do, right? Yes or no? Right? In the same way, I'm going to deal with this expression, this ugly expression, I'm going to deal with this in the same way. Okay? Many of us, we get scared by looking at infinite series. Right? There's nothing to be scared of. So what I'm going to do is, I first need to figure out, let's say I call this as x. Let's say I call this as x, the whole thing as x. From where onwards do you think that this x is repeating again? I can see it is repeating again from this stage. Do you see that? From that term onwards, it is again x, isn't it? So can I say x is 1 by 2 root 3 under root of 6 minus x itself? Are you happy with this or not? I will not proceed till you say you are convinced with that. Just write CLR if it is clear. Because if you don't understand this, there's no point going forward. Everybody? Right? Muskan, Shitish, Rubav, Parvati, very good dear. Okay. Next is simple. I'm going to make a quadratic out of it. Let me take this base 2 root 3 on the other side. Okay. Let's square it. Okay. When you square it, you end up getting this quadratic equation. Okay. Now, is it factorizable? I hope so. It is factorizable. 72. 72 can be broken as 9 into 8. Yes. Yes, it is factorizable. So let's do that. Here I'll take 3x plus 3 minus 2. Sorry, minus. I'll take 2 and this is 4x plus 3. Okay. So I end up getting these two factors. Okay. Which eventually gives me 3x minus 2 as 0. That means x could be 2 by 3. Or it gives me 4x plus 3 is 0. That means x could be negative 3 by 4. Okay. Now, if you check, minus 3 by 4 cannot be your answer. The reason being, it is under root of something. Under root of something multiplied to a positive number, right? 1 by 2 root 3 multiplied to a under root of something is going to be a positive answer, right? So this answer is definitely rejected. Now, first question that arises in everybody's mind, if it was not supposed to be an answer, how did it end up coming in my answer? Now, this is something what we call as the extraneous roots. Okay. I will talk about it in detail in the chapter theory of equations. See, I'll explain you why these extraneous roots come into the system. See, many a times when we are dealing with irrational terms. So this is an irrational term, right? This is an irrational function, correct? We tend to square both the sides, don't we? Right? Sometimes we cube also, sometimes we raise it to a power of 4. So whatever, you know, cubing, squaring, etc. you're doing. When you do that, remember you are introducing extra roots into the system. Right? You are most welcome to do it. Nobody is stopping you from squaring both the sides. In fact, sometimes you have to square it. Without squaring it, you can't solve the question, right? But when you're squaring it, remember, boys and girls, you are introducing extra roots into the system. And when you're removing, when you're putting extra roots into the system unknowingly, towards the end exercise or towards the end, you need to remove those extra roots. You have to select them and remove them out. See, I'll give you a simple example. If I say x minus 1 equal to 0, what is the root of this? I'm sure most of you will say 1, correct? That's absolutely right also. Okay, 1 is the root of this. But let's say there is a student, Akhil, who does this. Okay, he squared both the sides. Okay, and then again he brings this 1 to the left side. Okay, and then he factorizes it. And then Akhil realizes that, oh, I have now produced two roots. I have got 1 and minus 1 both, right? What went wrong here? In fact, there is no problem with squaring. Okay, he did nothing wrong when he squared both the sides. But when he did that, when Akhil did that, he actually introduced an extra root into the system. Okay, so it is his duty to check whether this root satisfies the original equation or not. Since it will not satisfy, he has to remove, he has to discard that root from the system. Is that fine? Okay. Okay. Now, once you have got your x value as 2 by 3, basically what are you trying to solve, my dear students? You are trying to solve this problem, reduces itself to evaluating log of 2 by 3 to the base of 9 by 4. Right? Anybody can answer this. What is this? Minus half. Right. So your answer number C is going to be correct. Option number C is going to be correct. Okay. So with this, I will allow you to take a break. Let's break. Okay. And what time you want me to resume at? What time you want me to resume at? 15 minutes is good enough? Okay. 15 minutes is good enough? 30 minutes? No, yaar, I can't give so much break. Let's have 6:25. Okay. Let's meet at 6:25. Okay, Chitish. Any questions, anybody, meanwhile? Can I also take a break and come back? Telescopic means? What is telescopic, Kshitij? Brain is dead. Hey, save something for calculus, yaar. Lot of things are going to come your way. Okay? Chalo, all of you enjoy your break. So, calculus. Let's start with calculus. Now, again, just a quick poll. How many of you have been introduced to calculus already? Okay. I'm just going to launch a poll. Just say yes if you have been introduced to calculus before, and no if you know nothing about calculus. Not in any form. You have never been exposed to calculus in any form, whether through foundation course or something which you have learned on your own. Okay. Little bit derivatives. Okay. Fine. Never mind. So 60% of you say you have not been exposed to calculus in any form, neither through any kind of foundation course or any self-learning also you have not done. Okay. No worries. It's just to know your status as of now. It has nothing to do with, my lecture of calculus. So calculus, let me begin with a basic introduction. Okay. First of all, just a brief idea. What are we learning through calculus? Why did we need this field of mathematics, right? As you would see, the evolution of mathematics, we started with geometry, where we started talking about figures and shapes, triangles, circles, etc. Slowly it evolved to algebra.
where we talked about, you know, equations, where we talked about variables. Then it slowly, you know, transitioned to, you know, what we call as analytical geometry, which is coordinate geometry. Okay. So we mix algebra along with geometry, and what we got is analytical geometry. So the coordinate geometry part that you are learning in schools is basically what we categorize as analytical geometry. And then came the, you know, a very, very modern field of mathematics called calculus. Okay. The word itself has been derived from the translation of the word small pebbles. Okay. Probably meant for computation or meant for counting. What is this field of maths? Why is this field of maths actually required? Wasn't algebra or wasn't analytical geometry or geometry sufficient enough for all our needs? The answer to that was no. And hence, this modern day field of mathematics was required. Okay. Now, I'll give you a simple example of why we need calculus. Let's say we have a function. Okay. We know this is your input, right? And you know y is your output. Okay. Now, if you want to study the changes in the output when there is a very, very small change made in the input, okay, what we call as infinitesimal change. If you make a very, 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 very small change in the input, okay, how does my output get affected by this small change? Is what actually is a subject matter studied under calculus. Okay. Now there are a lot of application of calculus, but this is how primarily it was originated through the works of two famous mathematicians, one being Newton and other being Gottfried Leibniz. So these two gentlemen were instrumental towards the invention of this field of mathematics, which we call as calculus now. Okay. Newton was more instrumental in working towards a segment of calculus which is now called as differential calculus. Okay. I'll talk about what is differential calculus. It's basically a calculus which deals with very, very small changes in, you know, input or output side of any functionality. Okay. Differential, the word itself means a change which is as good as no change at all. Now, how did he end up working on differential calculus? I'm sure you would have heard of a guy's name called Edmund Halley. Have you heard of this name, Edmund Halley? Yeah, Halley's Comet, absolutely correct, Ansh. Okay. This guy was super rich. So one day he came to Newton and he said, "See, boss, I'm going to give you a lot of money. Okay. I want you to work on, you know, the concept of the gravitational force between celestial bodies." Okay. So he basically came for, you know, some kind of theories which he wanted Newton to develop on, you know, how the gravitation force between these celestial bodies change, you know, with respect to their distances. Okay. Later on, he was the pioneer in the field of gravitation also, where he worked on a lot of gravity related concepts. Okay. Remember the other day I showed you a slide that during the bubonic plague in 1665, he worked on his theories of gravity. Okay. So that time he was working on how does the gravitational force between two planetary bodies change with respect to their distance? Now, of course, we know the formula now, that is gmm by r square. I'm sure when Dheera sir takes up the gravitation chapter with you, you'll come to know about that formula as well. So what happened is that between two planetary bodies, okay, the gravitation pull, okay, dependent on the distance between them. So if this distance changed by a very small amount, that is what I call as infinitesimal change. Infinitesimal means infinitely small. Infinitely small. So this word is an amalgamation of these two, two words, infinite, small, infinitesimal. Okay. So when this gap changed by a very, very small amount, how does the force change in that respect. So how does the output change when the input, let's say force is a function of the distance between these two planetary bodies. How did this force change when that distance between the two planetary bodies change infinitesimally? That is what Newton was actually working on the request of Edmund Halley. And there he, you know, stumbled upon a lot of concepts of differential calculus, right? On the other hand, Gottfried Leibniz was working on the concept of accumulative calculus. Accumulative calculus means when you add these small things, right? How do you figure out what is the bigger thing? Okay. So he was working on something which we call as the integral calculus. The word integral calculus came from the word integration. Integration means putting together very, very small quantities. For example, you can say this earth is an integration of dust particles, correct? Our body is an integration of all these cells that we have. So his field of calculus was something different from that of Newton. But nevertheless, the works of both these mathematicians were linked by something called fundamental theorem of calculus. It was linked by what we know as fundamental theorem of calculus. Okay, I'll introduce this concept to you in class 12th. Okay, guys, there is something very unfortunate again. Okay, through this video, I would like to, you know, put a request to the government secretaries, to all the officers sitting in the education department. Please, please do not treat physics and maths separately in class 11th and 12th. Yes, it is a very ironical thing that you are studying vectors in physics now, but you will be studying vectors in maths in class 12th. You will be studying calculus in physics now, but officially the 70% part of the calculus is studied in class 12th. Okay. So there is a very, very bad correlation, or you can say a very, very bad mismatch of concepts of physics and maths in 11th and 12th. Now, I do not understand the rationale for the CBSE board to do that, but I speculate that they probably have done this to make your, you know, curriculum lighter. Okay, so they have taken a deviation from the logical flow only to make your 12th more lighter because it's a board year for you. Okay, so they want to keep it as lighter. Okay, never mind. See, these are things which are beyond our control. So unfortunately, fortunately, we have to abide by the rules set in by the government. So I'll just give you an idea what is there in calculus for you for this entire 2 years. As I already told you, calculus is, you know, divided into two parts. One is the concept of differential calculus. Under differential calculus, you people will be studying. Under differential calculus, you people will be studying primarily these three concepts. Number one, the concept of limits, which probably I'm going to start today. Then you're going to study the concept of derivatives. And then finally, you are going to study the concept of application of derivatives. Okay. Out of these three, the first chapter is what you are going to study in 11th, but that too not completely. Okay, you will study only one aspect of limits. Okay, the major aspect you will study in class 12th along with a chapter called limit continuity and differentiability, what we call as LCD. Okay, but remember, without limits you cannot understand derivatives. So we say derivative is an application of limits. The next concept is the concept of derivatives, which half you are going to study in 11th. And again, a major part you are going to study in 12th. For example, in 11th, you will be studying just the methods of differentiation. Like what are the basic rules which are useful for differentiating a function. But you will learn how to differentiate complicated functions only in class 12th. And application of derivatives is a chapter which is completely in 12th. So as you can see, we touch upon only half of these two chapters in class 11th. And major part of the differential calculus lies in class 12th. Okay. The second aspect of calculus is your integral calculus. Integral calculus comprises of four major chapters, and they are indefinite integrals, indefinite integrals, which is completely studied in class 12th. Okay. Unfortunately, you'll start using integration in physics. I think very soon in kinematics, let's say rigid body motion, in question related to SHM, chapter related to moment of inertia, etc. You'll start applying integrals. But again, in maths, you're going to study in class 12. Sorry. Your seniors are actually studying it right now. Next is definite integrals. Again, you're going to study this chapter in 12th. Okay. Now, many people ask, are these two related to each other? Yes. You can say there is a bit of overlap. But remember, indefinite integral basically is a raw form of integration. Definite integral basically works on properties. Oh, okay. There are a lot of properties which we'll be talking about, which will help us to solve definite integral problems. As a prima facie, the way to distinguish it is definite integral has limits, has upper and the lower limits. So if you integrate something from A to B, you are performing a definite integral on it. But if you just integrate without any limits of integration, we are performing indefinite integrals on it. Okay, we are going to touch upon a few of these concepts in the bridge course. Then comes application of integration or application of integrals. This chapter basically helps us to find area under some peculiar functions. See, this is another application of calculus. When I ask you, what is the area under this square? I'm sure everybody will take not even a second to say a square, correct? Or let's say area of a circle, right? Pi r square. But if I say, what's the area under this, function like this, okay? Let's say from 0 to a, then probably you'll not be able to answer it without the knowledge of calculus, okay? For that matter, you will not be able to find out the length of, curves like this, correct? There is one typical flyover in Indiranagar. I don't know whether you've seen that. It has got this typical kind of, bending in that, okay? So with our analytical geometry, we are not able to find the length of such curvilinear structures, right? So we need to use calculus for that. Okay. Of course, one way is you take a string and, go along the path, but that itself will have some errors, right? Because when you're taking it through strings, you may be having some, kind of linear term replacing a actual curve. Okay. So here, or to answer such kind of questions, that is what we call as accumulative calculus, which is covered under application of integrals. But in your class, sorry, this is also a class 12 topic. And in a class 12th, we'll be only talking about one such application, which is the area under curves. This is what we are going to talk about, AUC. Finding the length of the curves is something which probably would be required in your APs. People who are writing advanced placements, you would require the idea of, such length of arc, what we call it. No, we don't do length of arc. We even don't do the volume of, rotation of a surface. We only do area under curves in your CBSE class 12 curriculum. Okay. And finally, we have a mix of both integration and differentiation, which we call as differential equations, where you will be learning how to solve equations which are made up of derivatives. Okay, so that is the last part of the calculus part. And this is also in 12th. So let me tell you, 95% of calculus comes in 12th, and almost your 70% of the topics in class 12th would be made up of calculus. Okay. So you must be wondering, why are we doing this chapter in the bridge course? Because yes, you will be needing it in every, small concepts in physics and to a certain extent in chemistry as well. Okay. So with this brief understanding, let me start with the concept of limits and derivatives. limits and derivatives. Okay. Now, before I start into this concept, I would like all of you to pay attention to a scenario. So I have a question for all of you. Okay. Let's say you are traveling from Bangalore to Mysore. Okay, so let's say on the y-axis we have displacement, displacement signified by s, and you're traveling from Bangalore to Mysore. Okay, let's say this distance here is 130 kilometers. Okay, and you take 5 hours to reach. Okay, let's, this is your time axis. So you start from t equal to 0 from Bangalore, and you reach at t equal to 5, and unit is hours. Okay, and this is how your displacement versus time graph looks like. Okay, let's say this is how you, yeah, okay, so this is exactly, you know, this. Okay, now answer these two small questions that I am going to ask you. Number one question: what's your average speed? You must be wondering, sir is asking such a simple question. Absolutely. So basically, you all gave me the answer as 26 kilometers per hour. Now, this was not a challenging, you know, question for you, because all you did was, what is the total change in the displacement, right, from B to M, divided by what is the total change in the time as you went from B to M. So this displacement was 130 kilometers, and you took 5 hours for that. And there you go, you get 26 kilometers per hour. Okay, so no doubt about this, nothing very, very difficult about this. But now my second question is slightly tricky. My question is, what was the speed of your car at t equal to 3 hours? Let's say this is your t equal to 3 hours. At this instant, at this very instant, when your clock exactly, let's say you started your journey at 12 noon, okay, and you reached Mysore at 5 p.m. I want to know how much was the speed of your car from this graph when the clock struck 3. Yes, Ansh. Okay. This is just a, you know, indication for you, because you know it. I want this question to be answered by all of you, not only Ansh. How did you figure that, Auro? You gave me a value. How did you figure that out? Can you can unmute yourself and talk? No, geometrically. See, this curve is given to you. Okay. From this curve, do anything you want. You have been given a scale. You have been given every instrument that you want to. From this, you measure out this graph, you measure out the velocity of the car that you were traveling on exactly when the clock struck 3 p.m. Now, this is something which many of us may not be able to answer right now. Right? Why we are not able to answer this question right now is because we have always been used to finding the speed by taking the change in the displacement or change in the distance by change in the time. But here I'm not allowing you for that change, because I'm asking you the velocity or the speed exactly at a pinpoint. Exactly at when your clock was showing 3 p.m., what was the speedometer of your car reading? It's something which baffles most of us. It surprises most of us. It takes most of us to our back foot. Because to know the speed, we have been always been taught that there has to be a change in the displacement and there has to be a change in the time. So when I say 3 p.m., how much change will you make from 3 p.m.? Right? That is something which is confusing right now. Will you see how much your car has traveled between 3 p.m. to 3.01 p.m.? Will you see that? Right? So many of us would be thinking, oh, let's say between 3 p.m. to 3.01 p.m., how much is the displacement of the car that we'll figure out, and we'll divide it, we'll divide this by 1 minute, correct? We'll divide it by 1 minute and you'll get the speed. But do you think this is going to give you the right answer? Because somebody else can argue, why did you take a minute? You could have taken a second, correct? I could have seen how much did my car move from 3 p.m. to 3.0001 p.m. That means in that 1 second, it may be a very small move, a very tiny move. How much did my car move in that 1 second? That distance divided by 1 second will give me the speedometer reading or the speed of the car. But somebody else can argue, why even 1 second? Time is a, you know, continuous quantity. Take 1 microsecond. In 1 microsecond, how much did your car move divided by 1 microsecond? That should be the speed of your car. And trust me, guys, there is no limit to how small an interval you can take for that time gap. Somebody can say, take 1 nanosecond. Somebody can take 1 picosecond, 1 femtosecond, right? Right? Now, do you understand the problem here? The problem situation is, how much should I allow my car, or how much time should I allow my car to move? And that time gap that you can allow your car to move can be a very, very infinitesimal time gap. That means if you find how much did your car move, okay, in a very, 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 very small time gap, where this time gap is as good as tending to zero, this probably will give you the speed of the car at 3 p.m. Okay. And later on, you'll come to know that it is basically obtained by creating a tangent over here, and the slope of this tangent will give you the speed of the car. Okay. So I'll address this question. I'll justify this solution of mine in the later part of this chapter. But try to understand, what are we studying? We are trying to study something which we call as instantaneous change. So now, it's a world where we live in instantaneous changes. We are trying to study something which we call as instantaneous change. Your junior classes, you were studying average change. Now grow up. It's not a world anymore of studying average changes. It's a world of studying changes which are happening at every instance. You are growing in height as I speak to you, even though you cannot see it happening, you know, but all of us, we grow, or let's say I'm becoming older or I'm becoming thinner as the moment I speak to you, right? So most of the things happening around us, they are instantaneously changing. Any small government decision taken will instantaneously, you know, fluctuate the Sensex market, people who are interested in stocks and all, okay? They fluctuate on real-time basis. That's why we need a graph for it. Okay. We cannot afford to now study average changes, right? It's not like, okay, now let me sleep today, I'll purchase a stock tomorrow. Who knows, within one, you know, Modi makes one decision and stock markets crash out, right? So as a person who is working, whether in the field of science or in the field of economics, you need to be aware of instantaneous changes happening around you. I'll give you an example. Let's say you are an IAS officer. Okay. I'm sure some of you would be having, you know, IAS officers in your family. This is the, you know, biggest government post anybody can occupy as an executive, other than, okay, of course, the MLA, MPs and all. Now, these guys, they need to take decisions. They need to take decisions, right? Now, you know that the food market is heavily dependent on the price of fuel, correct? A farmer, in order to cultivate his crops, would need diesel, would need petrol, would need kerosene to run his motors, right? Of course, it depends upon so many other factors like price of seed, price of fertilizers, the price of water, the price of machine. So let's say one of the factors I take is where your food is a function of diesel. Okay. Now, let's say as an IAS officer, you know that what is the relation which governs food and the price of the diesel, correct? Now, if you want to see how much does the price of food, let's say any food item, it may be a dal item or it may be a rice item or it may be a wheat item. Let's say if you make a small change in the price of the diesel, okay? Let's say you make a small change in the price of the diesel, okay? How much does the price of the food change because of that? If you want to study this change, you must be knowing calculus in that sense, right? So even a person who is sitting on a post which is non-scientific, even in the administrative post, you should be aware of how is your output fluctuating with respect to the input. So if you increase the price of diesel by 1 rupee today, how will a poor farmer get affected because of that? How would the price of cultivation change because of that? And how would the price of food that eventually people like you and me will be having, we have to purchase the food from the grocery stores, how will we be affected by that? So he will basically do a sensitivity check. He will see how much is the change in the price of the food with respect to the change in the price of the diesel happening when this change is very, very small. So first he will note this data. Okay, let's say this data is a huge value. Let's say it is 100, which means that if he makes 1 paisa change in the price of diesel, it will lead to 1 rupee increase in the price of food, right? And trust me, many of us in our country will sleep without having food because of this 1 paisa increase in the price of fuel. So as a person who is at a powerful position like this, you need to know how sensitive is a commodity with respect to another commodity. And for that, you need calculus, my dear friends. Okay. Such is this, important concept for us. It is not just about studying speed and time relation, right? It is about studying how is an output, right, changing with respect to input. So if you change your input to delta X, how is your output getting changed? How is your output getting changed? So it's a field of mathematics which tells you how is this quantity, affecting your decisions. Is this fine? Okay. So with this example, basically, I wanted you to bring your notice to the field of instantaneous changes. Okay. And given that I have written something like tending to zero, basically, this concept itself comes from the concept of limits in calculus. So let us talk about it for the next half an hour or 36 minutes of our class, the concept of limits. Now, I would request all of you to put your pen down, put your pens down. Okay. Okay. Nothing should be there in your hand. Just listen to me. Whatever I'm going to write down, wherever it is required, I'll ask you to copy it. But just listen to me, because in the first go, this concept may be slightly confusing. Okay. It's by experience. From the last 12 years, I have been teaching this. And I realized that in the first go, many people don't get this right. I'm not saying you will also not get it. God forbid that you get everything, correct? You should not be struggling with anything. So just listen to this, because don't waste your time writing anything down. When I say limit of a function as x tends to a, what do I mean from that? I'm not explaining you the meaning of this. This is a term which you'll come across a lot. The moment you open the first chapter of calculus, you will see this expression. So let me explain you what does this mean. And before I explain you what does this mean, I would like you to understand what does this mean. This is also a concept which many people don't get it correct. Okay. Correct, Mriganka. When I say x tends to a, first of all, get the pronunciation right. X tends to a. Many people call x approaches a. What does it mean? It means that x is coming close and close and close and close to a fixed value a, but never achieving it. Let me take an example. When I say x is tending to, let's say, 2, Okay, so x is a dynamic variable. It's changing every time. And as it is changing, it is trying to come as close as possible to 2, but never achieving 2. For example, it can take values like 1.9. It can take values like 1.99. It can take values like 1.999. It can take values like 1.99999 and so on, but it will never achieve a 2. So it is still moving towards 2, but not achieving 2. It can also take values like 2.1, 2.01, 2.001, 2.0001, etc. And it will slowly move towards 2. It will slowly move towards 2, but will never achieve 2. Please remember, you have x will never achieve 2. Please get this right. Any questions? So what I'm trying to say is that on a real number line, let's say 2 is here, then you are trying to approach 2 from left side. This is what we call as approaching 2 from the left side of 2. Left side means from values which are lesser than 2 towards 2. Or you can approach 2 from the right side of 2. Let me show it by the blue color. Sorry. Okay. When you approach 2 from the left side of 2, that means you can take these kind of values. We say that you are approaching 2 minus, or what we call as you are approaching 2 from the left hand side of 2. Get these terms correct. Okay. I've not yet talked about limit. I'm just explaining you x tending to a means what. Okay. When you are approaching 2 from the blue arrow side, that means you are approaching 2 from the right hand side of 2, and we write it as x tending to 2 plus. Please note, it doesn't mean 2 minus doesn't mean minus 2. Don't get me wrong. 2 minus means you are approaching 2 from a lesser side of 2. That means 1.9, 1.99, 1.999, 1.99999, 1.99999, like that. Okay. When you are approaching 2 from the positive side, or you can say from RHL, right hand side, means you are approaching 2 from a higher side of 2. Let's say 2.1, 2.01, 2.0001, 2.0001, like that. Okay. But in both the cases, you are not reaching 2. It is still a motion that x is performing. X is still in motion, you can say. It is still dynamic. Okay. This is what we call as the right hand side. Approaching 2 from the right hand side. Any question regarding right hand side, left hand side? By the way, there can only be two sides because a real number line is, you know, a single directional. Yes, Ansh, what I meant from the entire explanation was I'm very close to 2, but I'm not equal to 2. Okay. It's like, however great a batsman I am very close to Sachin, but I cannot become Sachin. Okay. Okay. Now try to understand. So x tending to a is clear to all of you, right? No doubt about it. Now, what is this full expression? What is this full expression? If you say limit of a function as x tends to a is a value L, it means that, all of you get this, it means that as x approaches a, whether from left side of a or right side of a, doesn't matter, your f of x will either approach L or will be equal to L. This is the meaning of the limit of a function as x tends to a is equal to L. Any question? I'll take a pause over here. L is the limit. See, I've written it as L, no? So what I'm trying to explain here, I'm repeating my words once again, my dear students. See, x is the input, f of x is the output. If x is approaching a, f of x is also trying to approach something. Or it may also achieve something. I'll tell you when does it achieve something, when does it approach something. So as x is moving, f of x is also moving. So as x approaches a, f of x will approach a quantity, which is what we call as the limit of the function. So L is a fixed value, just like a is a fixed value. Correct? So limit is a fixed finite value to which the function is trying to go or will achieve as x is going towards a. Are you getting my point? Like, so it's like if I'm trying to go towards a dried well, correct? My feet are, let's say, x, and my destiny is, let's say, y. So as my feet approach the well, my destiny approaches death, right? Sorry to take a very sad example like that, but this is how you can understand. As your input is approaching a, output is approaching some fixed value, and that value is what we call as the limit. So Anusha has a question. Unless x is at a point, how can y be equal to l? Okay, that's the whole point. X is not at a point. Even f of x is not at a fixed point. Both are moving. Correct? In many cases, even when x is moving, y may not move. For example, a constant function. Okay, let me ask you this. Let me give you a simple scenario, Anusha. Let's assume that you have a constant function like this. Okay. F of x equal to 2. If I ask you, what is your function trying to, what is your function f of x approaching towards as you approach 3? I'll say, sir, even if you approach 3 from the left or right, your function always remains 2. So 2 is your limit. 2 is your limit in that case. But many a times there are functions which are moving. For example, instead of a straight line, I had a, let's say, a linear line like this. Let's say the line was like this. Okay. Let me take an example of a line x plus 1. Okay. Now, if I say as x tends to, let's say, 4. Okay. As x tends to 4, what does this y tend to? Or what does this f of x tend to? That means I am evaluating this limit. You will say, as you come very close to 4, okay, whether from the left or the right, your value of y will be very close to 6. Very close to 5. Right? So this 5 becomes your limit. Try to understand this. Okay? Now you must be wondering, yo, why did we need limit for this? We could put 4 over here and got 5. No, why sir is telling all these kind of, you know, coming from left and coming to right? See, this is not as easy, right? Because you cannot put 4 into this, because you cannot achieve 4. You are either slightly lesser than 4 or slightly bigger than 4, but you are not 4 exactly. X is not exactly 4. Okay. But the function is still tending towards a fixed value, and that is 5. I'll give you more examples. Let's have patience right now. I know at this point of time, a lot of questions come in our mind. What is he saying, tending to, and he's putting the value? Just relax. It's a phase which everybody undergoes. I've also undergone the same phase. Your seniors also underwent the same phase. Probably any senior of yours who has learned this will also go the same phase. So have patience right now. I will slowly and slowly unwind the entire story. As of now, whatever I'm saying, is that clear or not? No, f of x may tend to that value, may achieve that value also sometimes. Ansh, to answer your question, in this case, it will never achieve 5. Right? But in this case, it has achieved 2. So it may tend to also, it may achieve also. That depends upon scenario to scenario. Does that answer your question, Ansh? Okay, things will be more clear to you as I proceed with this concept. Okay, as of now, just listen to what I have to say. Okay, so basically, what I want to highlight here is that as x is moving, your f of x is also moving. So as x is moving towards a fixed quantity a, f of x is also moving towards a fixed quantity l, and that l is called the limit. It may achieve it. It may just tend towards it. This is what I have spoken so far in this discussion of limits. Any question here, please highlight. Yes, Shubhi, tell me. Okay, you had a question on top. So can I, if you put that arrows for me, I don't see all your chats together. Okay. So can I say that one is the limit of the fractional part function? Again, we'll come to it. I don't want to dump you with too much of, you know, information in the first introduction. Okay. See, you don't know everything about a person when you meet it for the first time, right? Okay. You have to give that person some time in order to more know more about it. So let's cheat. Limit is like a stranger for me, at least for, you know, people in this session. Let us learn more about it. Many things will be clear. Okay. Of course, Oshik, I'll give you. When does a function achieve a limit? That also I'll tell you. Auro, what is that question? No, needn't be. X may be still moving, Auro, but f of x may achieve L. I gave you, you know, that example, constant function. Okay. Wait. Many things will be clear when I tell you the next step, next things. Okay. Now, all of us, let us try to understand first thing here. Limit is basically the value that the function achieves if you approach x from either the left side of A or the right side of A. Okay. You must get the same value irrespective of whether you are tending towards x from the left side of A, which what we write it as this, or if you tend to the function or you tend to the value of A from the right side of A. So these two values must be equal first of all, and whatever they are equal to, that is your limit value. Okay, that is what we call as the limit of the function as x tends to A. Now, in order to show you this, first of all, I'll give you some cases. Okay, cases where your limit will exist and what is the value of that, I'll tell you, and cases where your limit will not exist. Okay, so somebody was asking, does the limit of a function always exist? The answer is no. When does it not exist? Let us try to figure it out from these two examples. Let me first begin with a very simple example that most of you would be able to understand very easily. Let's say I take a function x square minus 1 by x minus 1. Okay. X tending to 1. Okay. Oh, sorry. I should not write here. So let's say this is your function, and let's say I want to evaluate. Limit of this function as x tends to 1 minus, that's the number one question for us. Number two question is, I want to evaluate limit of this function as x tends to 1 plus. And finally, I want to evaluate what is the limit of this function as x tends to 1. So for the purpose of better understanding, what I did was, I am separately evaluating what we call as left hand limit. So this is what is called as the left hand limit. Why we call this as a left hand limit? For the simple reason that we are now approaching x from the left side of 1. Okay, so the answer that you get is what we call as the left hand limit. Okay, this is what we call as the right hand limit. And remember, what did I tell you just now? When both your left hand limit, in short form, I can call it as LHL. When you both LHL and RHL are equal, and whatever they're equal to, that becomes your limit. That becomes your limit. So we'll be evaluating from the result of the first and second, what is your limit finally. Okay, let's do this exercise. Yes, Auro, what is that question? Why? What is the complete question? Why are we doing it? You're asking that. Oro. Anusha, you'll get all your answers. Okay, let me put a thumb rule. Let's not ask any question till I'm done with this exercise. Okay. Whatever I have on my screen, exactly at 7:25, I'll stop whatever I'm going to tell, and I'm then going to entertain your questions, if at all you will have any. Okay. So I bet you will have no questions till I finish this exercise. Yes, if LHL is not equal to RHL, we say limit doesn't exist. So let me write that down also if you want me to write. So that's number two. If LHL is not equal to RHL, it implies L does not exist. Okay. And I'm going to give you instances of that as well, Kshitish, in this example. Okay. Ansh, Auro, Anusha, I can very well understand what's your question. Just wait for me to get on over with this exercise. Okay. Now, before I start evaluating this, I would like you all to, you know, look at this function very carefully. Very, very carefully. Many of us, you would have already noticed that your numerator is factorizable. Correct? You can write it like this. Correct. And many of us would have a feeling or would have this tendency inside us. Let's cancel them off. My first question to all of you is, can we do that? Can we cancel out x minus 1 from the numerator and denominator? Guessing no, no. Okay. The answer is you can do so. If you know your x is not equal to 1. But you cannot do so if your x is equal to 1. That means if your x is 1, your function will actually become an undefined expression. Getting this point? This is very important. So when I redefine this function, again, recall the word redefine. I have been using this word. Okay. If you redefine this function f of x, this function f of x is behaving as x plus 1 when x is not 1, and it is behaving as undefined. That means I don't know what to do with this function exactly when x is equal to 1. Is this convincing enough for everybody? Are you happy with this? Okay. Now, why I cannot cancel it? The answer to that is very simple. You cannot cancel 0 from the numerator and denominator. Guys, if you're doing it, you are committing one of the biggest blunder in mathematics. For example, let's say 2 into 0 is 3 into 0. You cannot bring this 0 down and say, let's cancel 0 and 0. And you'll end up getting the biggest discovery of mankind. That is 2 is equal to 3. Right? So when you were canceling x minus 1 and x minus 1, please remember you could not have done that if your x were 1. Correct? But if your x is not 1, if your x is not 1, you can definitely cancel it off. Okay. Now somebody was asking me about a hole in the graph. So this is an answer to your query. If you actually plot this function graph, you would realize that this function is behaving as y equal to x plus 1 line. Sorry for that. I'll draw a much better line than that. Let me draw it in white. Your function is behaving as a y equal to x plus 1 line at all the points, but just at one point, which is x equal to 1, there is a hole. I'm putting a hole over here. Okay. So there is a hole in this function at x equal to 1. Okay. Now, those who were asking, can we even evaluate the limit when there is a hole at the function at that point? The answer to your question is yes. We are now going to do that. We are now going to evaluate this limit because I have nothing to do what is happening at A. In this case, I'd have no business whatsoever at whatever is happening to the function at x equal to 1. whether it is defined, whether it is undefined, whether there is a coronavirus sitting over there, whether there is a bomb blast over there. I don't care what is happening at A, because X never reaches A. Is it tending to A? So what is happening just before that point, whatever is happening, and just after that point, whatever is happening, I just care about those values. And are they tending towards a single value? And that value is my limit, is what I am worried about. I'm not worried about what is happening at one in this case. Does that answer your question? Even if there is a hole, what do we do? Now, trust me, Anusha, 99.99999, you can say, tending to 100% questions will be of this type to you, where you don't know what is happening to the function at that given point. And this clarifies the second doubt of students who believe that, or who wrongly believe that, limit is all about substituting values, right? It's not that easy, guys. If it was substituting values, why would we have studied it, right? Why we would make our own life so difficult? So you can't evaluate, you know, answers by substituting x value. So if I have to evaluate this limit, I can't put 1 over here in this function, because if I do, I get 0 by 0, which is undefined, right? So it clarifies two of your questions, I'm sure. Now, finally, how do we evaluate it? For that, I would like you, okay, to first evaluate the first part, left-hand limit. Let me complete that, then I will answer any further questions, okay? So for left-hand limit, I'm going to make a small table for you. Okay. I'm now approaching 1 from negative side of 1, and I'm going to see what all values my f of x is tending towards. Okay. Then we'll be able to figure out that finally it is going towards which fixed value. Okay. Now suggest me certain values which are less than 1. I'm sure you would suggest 0.9 first. Okay. Now tell me, when x is 0.9, what is your f of x? You may use this definition if you want. When x is 0.9, that means it is not 1, f of x will be what? 0.9 plus 1. What is that? 1.9, correct, Shitesh? Okay. Now you can yourself figure out what is happening. When I take 0.99, what does f of x become? 1.99. When I take 0.999, what does f of x become? 1.999. When I take 0.99999, it becomes 1.99999. You can see yourself, my dear students, that as you are going slowly and slowly and slowly and slowly towards 1, this guy f of x is going slowly and slowly towards which value? Which value? Towards 2. Yes, towards 2. So this answer to the first part of the question is, the left hand limit is 2. Is there any question now with respect to evaluating the left hand limit? Auro, am I audible? Can you all hear me? Mic test. Yeah. People can hear me. Auro, something wrong with your system, dear? Oh yeah, you can hear me now. Okay. Let us do a similar exercise when I am approaching 1 from the right side of 1. So let me again make a simple column. Okay. So now I am choosing such values which are slightly higher than 1. And let's see, what does my function approach to? The first thing that I can put is 1.1. Okay. So again, we can use the very same definition. X plus 1 when x is not equal to 1, because 1.1 is not equal to 1. So I can put x as 1.1 and I'll get 2.1. Okay, good. So I'll put 2.1 here. Now still further close the gap. See, my role is to move towards 1. So I'm closing the gap. So from 0.1 gap, I'm making it 0.01 gap. Now my function will become 2.01. Again, I'm still closing the gap. I'm still getting closer to a fixed value. See. And my dear, as you're growing slowly and slowly towards 1, this guy is again slowly and slowly moving towards which value? 2 again. So here you see that your right hand limit is also 2. And are both the values same? You'll say yes, both are 2. So your limit will also become 2. Right? So you can see that even when the function is not defined at that point, even when there was a hole there, even when there was a hole here, the limit is still there. The limit is 2 for that. It's a finite fixed value. So limit is always a finite value, guys. I forgot to write this down in the first this thing. Your limit is always a finite value, remember. Okay. However, left hand limit and right hand limit, they may be infinity or minus infinity. I will expose you to more problems. Don't worry about them right now. Yes, yes, Oshik, I am sure it is 2. Okay, Ansh is asking a question. Okay, Ansh, when you are approaching 0 for 1 by x, now see the graph. 1 by x graph, as we have all figured out, it is like this, correct? If I approach from the left side, my left hand limit is negative infinity. If I approach from the right side of 0, my right hand limit is positive infinity, right? Anyways, negative infinity, positive infinity are very, very far apart. Limit does not exist. Got your question, got your answer, Ansh? Okay. Now, of course, a natural question will arise in your mind that every time sir is giving such examples where left hand limit, right hand limit are equal, right? Now, I will cite an example where left hand limit is not equal to right hand limit. Listen to that example. Okay. Very, very nice example I'll give you. Do you remember this function gif of x? Okay. Now I'll give you an example where I'm evaluating the limit of the gif of x function. So this is now your f of x function when x tends to 1. Okay. Let us do the same exercise. Let us make 2 columns for left hand limit and the right hand limit. Okay. Let's make 2 columns. One is where I will approach 1 from the left side and I'll see what values this gif function takes, and the other in which I will approach 1 from the right side and then see what values my gif takes. Okay, let's start the process. Okay, 0.9. If I put 0.9 in the place of x, what does f of x give out to you? 0. 0.99, 0. 0.999, 0. So as you can see, as you're going towards 1, this guy has already achieved a value. That's what I was telling you a little later on. It may achieve also that value. Okay. F of x, there is no restriction. But x is still moving. F of x may tend to a value or achieve a value. Okay. So this is what we call as the left hand limit. So left hand limit is 0. Now let's do the same exercise when I am approaching 1 from the right side of 1. So 1.1, what is the value? 1. 1.01. I'm closing the gap. See, this is my 1. I'm trying to approach 1 from this side. I've already approached 1 from this side. Now I'm approaching 1 from the right side. What will be 1.01 GIF? 1 only. 1.001? 1 only. 1.0001? 1 only. So as you're going towards 1, this is stagnated at 1, and that is what we call as the right hand limit. And this is the first example that you're seeing is where the limit does not exist, because left hand limit is 0 and right hand limit is 1. So you will write D and E for it. Does not exist. Now I'm sure most of your questions would have been answered. Now one question still may be there in your mind. Sir, from how close you start? That question many people ask me. So let's say you're approaching 1. How close to 1 you start from? For example, you started from 0.9 over here. Could I have started it from, let's say, minus 10? Okay. Now the answer to that is you should start. See, ultimately you're going to converge towards 1. So there's no point starting from very far away. Correct? You can start from the neighborhood of that point. Neighborhood means very small gap here and there. Okay, and it's your call. It's your call from where you want to start. But ultimately, it doesn't matter from where you are starting. Your answer is going to converge anyhow to 0 if you start from any values left to 1. And it is going to converge to 1 anyhow you start from right side of 1. So, Shitish has a question. If so, one particular number exists for all values tending to A, then the limit is achieved. Yes. And both left hand and right hand value should be the same number, Shitij. If they're different numbers, limit doesn't exist. Arya Dilip, sir, can you show the previous screen because I have a question? Sure, Arya, why not? There you go. Do you want me to drag it somewhere? Left, right, center? You want to see the right side of the screen, or you want to see the left side of the screen, or is it the position? Where do you want to see? You want to see this guy? Yeah, what question you have? You can ask, no need to type it out. Sir, in the function f of x, why you can't cancel x minus 1? Yeah, now, I was not evaluating limit at that time, Arya. I was just asking you the definition of the function in order to plot it. When I'm evaluating the limit, I can confidently cancel it. And that is what we call as the factorization method of evaluating the limit. That I will come to in some time. Probably next class, I will talk about it. Sir, is there an easier way to calculate? Of course, there is an easier way. We'll talk about it. This is called the informal approach. This is called the informal approach of evaluating the limit. Normally, we are not going to evaluate any of our limit by this approach because it is too lengthy and tedious. Thankfully, our functions were very, you know, sober. If your functions are complicated, oh my God, who's going to do this? Who's going to put 0.9, 0.99, 1.11? Tears will come out from my eyes, okay? Of course, there are methodologies set in to evaluate limit faster. We'll talk about it later on. Shitish has another question. Sir, can we say limit is average of the... not necessarily. Limit is a fixed value. An average itself may change. There are different types of averages, right? Okay. You cannot say it's an average, actually. LHL and RHL have to be the same, Shitish. Right? Even the average also come out to be the same for the same two quantities, but the first and foremost essential criteria is they have to be the same. Okay. Okay, one last thing I would like to highlight, just 1 minute, Auro. Many people think, I think Arabi had a question that, so for all integer points, does GIF limit does not exist? The answer to that is no. Let's say if you evaluate the GIF function x limit as x tends to 2.5, then it will exist and that will be 2. Okay, so it's wrong to say that. It is the GIF function limit doesn't exist for every point. No, it will exist for x tending to non-integral points. Is that what you were asking, Arabi? For integer points, it will not exist. Okay. Well, thank you so much, guys. I think I had just introduced a flare of limits inside you. I'm going to share an assignment with you. You just solve the initial few questions. I think the first 4 or 5 questions, I'll mention that in the on the group. Okay. And do not forget to take your logarithmic assignments on the group. Okay. Okay. So over and out from my side, I'm still there to answer a few of your questions.